You spend years making a name for yourself. When you're known by your number, that's fuel for the soul.
Our pole winner, winning crew chief, Michael Fatback McSwain.
Looks like George Jetson when he takes off.
Cars. He was slideways.
Slideways.
Last week, he had the save of the year.
It that didn't save it right then off turn two because he just hit the wall coming up on that straightaway. There's one of those black marks, DW.
Yes, sir.
This was one of several teams tested this week at Pocono. And unlike the big teams with the 10, 11 cars lined up in the shop, they have three cars ready to go and more in process. So they're trying to get caught up and get Sprague up and running well. Let's see here.
Kissed it.
You're driving up out of that hole. You're carrying so much speed, and the way to get around here is right up against the wall. Car gets just a little bit loose, just runs out of racetrack.
Starts back down in the hole, and as it comes up into that transition area right there, then it just wants to jump loose with you. You get behind on your steering, ain't nothing you can do about it.
So Sprague, 25th of 28.
In the 12, he felt that way, so he let Rusty win the battle.
Whoa, in the wall goes Casey Mears, turn four.
Casey got up out of the groove, got in that gray area up there, and into the wall he goes, and here's a big crash behind him.
Mike Skinner in the 4, Tony Raines in the 74. Looks like Jeff Green in the 1, caution is out, and Ward Burton in the 22 car.
Mike Skinner's car is really torn up, so is the 74. 22's driving off. Looks like he may not have but minor damage. The 1's got a lot of rear damage.
Steve Burns.
And Mike, Dale Earnhardt Jr. had to start from the back of the pack because of that incident in practice. He just said there's some damage to the right rear of my race car. Somebody got into me.
Let's talk a little about that. We've talked on previous telecasts how you build the front of the car as strong as you can, but build the rear of the car to have some crushability in it.
Yeah, if you bump into somebody, like that's where your radiator, that's where all the vitals are. So you got to take care of the front. You want the back cave in so you don't get spun out. But you'll see the 41. He gets up out of the groove down here and turns four. Takes off with him right there, wiggles a little bit. He gets up there where there's no grip whatsoever. He's coming back down the racetrack, and that's where the problem starts.
They just start stacking up behind him. There you see it going high and going low.
You'll see these guys. Everybody checks up. Looked like the 1 car checked up first. 4 got into him. And here come the rest of them.
Looked like Junior may have got in the back of Skinner as they came around. Let's have a look from Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s on board.
Yeah, Dale Earnhardt Jr., he definitely got in the back of Mike Skinner in the 4 car.
And you could hear it kissed off the wall just a little bit when he did.
Now, Robbie Gordon had that ignition problem, had to start in the back of the field. Here's how he saw it.
Threaded his way through there.
Wow.
Almost had to stop to do it, though.
Probably was giving him a few choice words for being back there in the first place.
Cars will pit to repair damage, and we'll be back to Dover Downs after this. Welcome back to Dover Downs, where we are under caution at lap 1. Casey Mears, who triggered this crash, has gone to the garage, and a couple of drivers who had practice problems and had to start in the back. There is one. Joe Nemechek, and there's the other, Dale Earnhardt Jr., got involved in it, Darrell.
Yeah, and that's the thing that you worry about, Mike, is when you got to start in the back like Dale Jr. did, and Joe Nemechek, something like this happens on the first lap. 41's down underneath on the outside there, and I think he just wobbled a little bit, bobbled a little bit, and it took off, hit the wall, and then, of course, everybody checked up.
Now watch behind Casey Mears, the right of your screen.
The 1 car seemed like he might have checked up in a hurry. The 4 rammed into the back of him, and the rest of it is as you can see.
Dick Berggren.
Well, Mike, Casey Mears has got significant damage to his car, perhaps the most serious problem. Brake rotor has broken off it, and without this particular piece being whole and on the right front, there's just no stopping that car. I mean, like, you can't even slow it down. Steve Burns.
He's about
trouble
6
here.
And a half
trouble,
seconds
trouble
being left. Jimmy Spencer in a 7 car.
Here comes Junior.
Out.
Junior just slid through.
Caution out at lap 38.
Greg Biffle just turned Spencer around right there. I don't know what he was thinking.
And all those cars were saved from going a lap down. Except, of course, Spencer.
I better be sure it wouldn't. It might have been the zero car. They look so much alike. It's hard to tell. I believe it actually was the zero car. Sorry, Greg. But the zero and the 16, I mean, if you just can't tell them apart.
Here's what Dale Jr. saw.
Boy, that right there is when you have to really, really sit on a hot stove and...
It looked like pots, but Jimmy Spencer just lost it, I think.
No. Just wait.
Roof flap deployed, right front pushed in. Now, there's the problem we're fighting with, and when you look at it across the racetrack half a mile away, one black and red car looks pretty much like another.
Now, I know people say, well, they got a yellow number on the top of that one, but, you know, we don't see it that much.
So now let's back that off to where we have to see them from at this distance.
So my sincere apology to Greg Biffle, and I think when we get a good look at what happened, I think we'll see the zero is pushing old Mongo out of his way.
So now NASCAR has decided that this will be the competition count as the competition caution. We're 38 laps into this race, and when pit road opens for everyone, which should be the next time by, this will count as the competition caution as well.
Yeah, pit road's closed right now. Of course, Jimmy Spencer comes to pit road. Also, Jeff Green in the one car who has some damage on the rear. The penalty would be, of course, go to the rear of the field. Jimmy Spencer, they didn't have any choice.
Spencer wasn't happy with his car here. So didn't qualify, didn't practice very well.
No, he was, but his car wasn't handling well at all. He's running up the racetrack, and that's what opened the door for the zero to get under him. But as they came off of four, the zero just got into the left rear of Jimmy and turned him around.
Smoke from Kenny Wallace.
Yeah, it's a left front tire rub. See that fender rubbing on that tire?
Yeah, you can see it right there, pouring off the left front fender. That's one of those places you don't want to cut a tire down at this place, because it's a long way from the bottom of the racetrack if you go up there and hit that wall.
John Andretti has made a pit stop. And here comes the leader right up on Kenny Wallace.
Caution
is out.
He's trying to run it back to the line here. Caution's out for rain.
That's going
to
be a big break for Kenny Wallace right there. It'll give him a chance to fix this tire.
Larry Foyt, he's coming around.
Trying to make his lap up, and he will get back on the lead lap.
And here's what happened to Kenny Wallace.
Got it back of John Andretti, yeah.
Andretti was slowing to come on to pit road. And if he was signaling, Kenny didn't see him.
Yeah, because we just saw John Andretti on pit road, the 43.
What's that song, It's Raining Again?
Sadly, yes.
Goodness.
But you know, you showed that big wad of cars a while ago that was racing side by side like Mark Martin.
AOL Chevy to the garage.
I expect they'll go in there and make a few chassis adjustments on that.
Whoa, Sterling Marlin sideways on the backstretch. The 40 car hits the wall hard.
I didn't like the way he and Jeff Gordon. I've said it over and over and over again. You can't run side by side.
Caution is out.
Fourth caution of the day at lap 115.
Never seen these two kids do that at Charlotte.
Can't tell.
Seemed to me like I remember this movie from Charlotte.
Sterling Marlin and Jeff Gordon.
Yeah.
Took us out.
Not sure.
Sal, tell him thanks for that.
Not sure how much damage. Oh, look at that right rear wheel wobbling. There's.
Guys, we're rolling.
You get two cars running so really close together.
It's coming up out of the hole right there off turn two, like you were talking a while ago, Darrell.
It's only enough room for one car, and you try to get two down in there, and you just, that's what happens.
Hits first with the right front and then with the right rear.
You see, Jeff, just that's where Jeff's been so good, is off the corner. But you need a lot of racetrack to be able to do that.
And at that speed, it don't take much of a little bump to get you out sideways.
I call that a nerf. But you see the damage.
Plink.
And trust me, when you got a guy underneath you like it and you're coming off the corner, you're drawing up in that car just hoping he doesn't hit you.
And it looked like it killed the right front. So Sterling has taken that car to the garage.
Bunch of cars. He's going to go down and hit that wall. Caution is out.
Going to leaders of 3 and 4.
Caution to lap 138 for Greg Biffle, the Busch Series champion. He's damaged the right front and a little bit to the right rear. Finally gets purchased there in the wet grass and comes around.
Yeah, he's been running. You know, he's been running decent. But the car just got a little bit loose on him coming off a four and around she came.
Joe Nemechek, who just had put those fresh tires on, he got one of his three laps back right then.
And we'll mention Casey Mears, who brought out the first caution of the day, is back on track, 130 laps down. Here's what happens to the 16 of Greg Biffle, turn four.
It's all by itself.
Very lucky with all those cars coming at him.
He almost wasn't all by himself. No.
Let's ride along. Briggs and Stratton on board, Cam.
We should be see everybody to pit road from
underneath Rusty Wallace, and that'll be third place. Oh, hard in the wall!
Jack Sprague, I believe, the zero car.
Here's coming more cars, still spinning. They're not done yet. They're all slowing down, running over each other.
Brett Bodine, Kyle Petty,
Kurt Busch, 97 car.
Where's Tony?
Too far back, I believe. Kevin Harvick's the one that's trying to get one of his two laps back in the 29 car. I believe he'll get one of them back, guys. Remember, he made that green flag stop.
Hope Kurt Busch gets going.
I don't think Tony Stewart was trying, but I don't think he made it.
Kenny Schrader also damaged, but Jack Sprague. Where is he? He pounded the wall coming off turn number four. Now Kyle's going to climb out. Sprague hit so hard, I can't believe that car made it back all the way around.
Probably over on the back.
No, it did. It's going to come to the pits. Watch the zero.
It's that little bobble right there. Call that the hospital wobble right there.
And everything starts happening behind him, and Jack was running well up in the top 10.
Thing I noticed about Jack's car, Larry, it seemed to be really good on the long run and probably a little loose on the get-go there, and it twitched on him. And of course, here these guys all come just piling in on each other. I'm not sure what's going on with the spotter guys today.
Kurt Busch got turned way sideways. Let's watch here. I think this is Biffle. Kurt Busch came around, and that got him into Kyle Petty, and then somebody turned to Brett Bodine. Sprague hit the wall hard, and that's him trailing all that smoke. He got the heck out of there.
You know, I know that this is just an observation, okay? But I know when they build racetracks, they don't build them where turn four is where all the action is. They surely can't think about that. Look, oh, Kyle is hot. He got ran over from behind. I know why he's hot. But how come is it all the racetracks always have trouble off in turn four, seems like?
Well, yesterday turn two was Calamity Corner. Today it seems to be turn four. Kurt Busch, who came in here fourth in the top 10 with a good bit of damage, at least five cars involved. Brett Bodine, who had stayed on the lead lap all day with left rear damage. Kenny Schrader with the hood up. Also damage on Jeff Green and Ward Burton. There is the hit list for this seventh caution, at lap 210.
A couple of times today, just out there, there seems to be a little spot there where they won't hook up. Steve Burns.
Well, Jack Sprague, you had a great run going. What put you back here?
I just lost it. That zero Pontiac was awesome. Tony did a great job. I've been tight in the middle and off, so he loosened me up a little bit. And I really wouldn't expect it to be that loose because it hadn't been all day. And it would have been fine. I went into three outside of Kenseth and behind Jeff, and my peripheral vision, I could see Kenseth wiggle, and it scared me a little bit. And I jerked the wheel, and when I did, I lost traction with the back and couldn't get it back. I had her hung out all the way off four, but I mean, I'm not even going to say I can't catch a break because I lost it. So, but I don't know. One of these days, we're running better.
Thanks, Jack.
Thank you.
Vance. Oh, Jimmy Johnson has crashed.
Caution is out. We're getting a report he may have hit oil.
Okay, Jimmy.
If it did hit oil.
Or I just lost it.
I just lost it. Just what Jack Sprague said. And Jimmy Johnson's chance for three in a row has crunched.
Same thing that happened to Matt Kenseth yesterday, leading the Busch race all by himself and spun off of turn two.
Now, what's this man's misfortune is another man's fortune. Tony Stewart, he's back on the lead lap.
Now, Ward Burton.
We've seen that.
His teammate
We've seen that before right there. That's that gravy that's coming. The radiator's got a heat exchanger in it for the oil. And they and when the heat exchanger busted last week in Kenny Wallace's car, caused the water and oil to mix together, looked the very same way, Larry.
And like I say, when you see the two teammate cars look the same 2 weeks in a row, you almost feel like it's the same problem.
Now, Jimmy Johnson said he just lost it, but if that fluid was getting down onto the racetrack, he may have gotten in it, and that stuff is slick.
Yeah, he probably doesn't realize. Well, he's pretty high up out of the groove, but if there's oil over there.
Steve Burns.
Leak in it, it mixed the oil and the water together, and it came out like that.
Very well to bypass it. Yeah, he just seemed to get loose off of two over there, and man, he hit that inside wall a ton.
Well, Darrell, you said he was running a little bit up out of the groove, and if that was spewing out the right side, there it is on on the in-car camera lens.
I think it just took off. He didn't realize that he hit the wall over there. Happened so fast, and you think you made a mistake, and you don't realize that there may have been something that was an extenuating circumstance.
With all the damage sustained, it's going to be tough to get that car back in the race. Here's the run on the outside. Crash. Casey Mears hits the wall, turn one.
Caution is out.
Well, that changes everything. Craig Biffle may have been involved in that with Casey Mears, who opened the day by wrecking on lap one. See damage the right front of Biffle's car. You saw from the onboard. Oh, boy.
I can't tell if that's... No, that is. Well, that's Biffle's car.
Yeah, some of that's past damage and some of it's new damage.
I'm going to tell you what, guys, here's going to be the real gamble. We know we will get this race restarted. We have 11 laps to go right now. We know we're going to go get back started. They've got 23 laps on their tires. This is going to be a tough, tough call on what do you do. Do you come to pit road? Do you stay out? What do you do?
Larry, you got 13 cars on the lead lap, so.
Larry, don't even mention me coming to pit road. Hello.
Watch from Greg Biffle. Briggs and Stratton on board.
Whoa. The 41 car just kind of drove up on top of the 16 the way it looked.
See right there, that good luck charm? I believe I'd find a new one. Track crews talking to Casey Mears.
Kenny Schrader is okay, climbed out of his car unhurt, and I tell you that first because when you see the video, you'll wonder how.
Gets around right there going down into turn one. Could be a nut. Oh, my goodness. Upside down.
Your internet cornered almost 200 miles per hour.
That had to be quite a ride right there. Gotta believe something's happened back here. My goodness, boy, does that not tell you how fast you're going? See how all that fire stayed out of the car?
Ken Schrader, turn one. Kyle Petty was the car behind, but I couldn't see. I don't think Kyle touched him, Darrell.
Yeah, I was trying to see myself. Something be interesting to see what Kenny has to say, because something happened to that race car.
We're under the first caution of the day at Pocono, Pennsylvania. This is NASCAR on Fox. Again, this time Dale Jarrett has climbed from his car okay after a fiery crash in turn one. We're under the second caution of the day.
And he'd just come out of the pits. He'd made a great pit stop. He was up to like sixth place. And boy, the car just was looking really good.
He'll ride with him here.
Uh-oh.
Tell you what, he hit that wall of fuel. You see all this fire. Remember, he just had made the pit stop like you talked about, Darrell. That's 22 gallons of fuel burning right
and
there.
And that clicking sound or that scraping sound that we heard, that's either tells me that the tire pressures were low and hadn't come up yet, or something happened to a tire.
Carrying the Hans device, the head and neck support. DJ is okay. That car went into the wall hard.
Yeah, he had actually moved up to the fifth position. We talked about how well he got on the pit road, so he had really made some ground up on that green flag stop.
Pit road will be open this time. This will be interesting to see who comes in, because most of them, 8 laps to go, and Kurt Busch has slowed down.
Got a tire down.
Caution is out.
Debris going everywhere.
Caution is out with 8 laps to go.
Boy.
Right front down.
Don't you know that you wish you'd have stayed out one more lap if you're Todd Bodine or a couple of these guys?
Because they said he could run them with lap 192, and it's lap 192 right now.
Boy, Kurt Busch got a lot of damage to the right front.
Now, that's what you talked about earlier, when you cut a tire and it comes apart.
I think he hit something. Tire didn't do all that damage.
It did something. It didn't do the whole right side, did it?
You know, Mike, you mentioned that stat about the drivers that not won here. I look at the top 10 right now in their running order. Seven of those guys have not been to victory lane this year either, including our top two, Tony Stewart right there in the 20 and Mark Martin in the 6.
Let's see what happened to Kurt Busch.
Here he comes down into, looks like the tunnel turn here.
Yep.
Moves over for his teammate and Balooey.
I'm going to tell you what, you blow a tire right there, you're lucky you don't go into that wall hard.
Not so sure. You know, he might not got out too close to the outside wall going down through there and run over something.
We saw something fly to the left, and it may have been a piece of tire, or it may have been something he ran over. Oh, boy.
A lot of debris out there.
Okay, well, we hadn't had this debate. Oh, you want to come down and get some tires, or?
Depends on where I'm running. We're going to get this race restarted, but with 23 cars on the lead lap, 22 or 23, keep me out there in that clean air, friend.
Okay, buddy.
Clean those tires off and be careful on this restart. Don't spin the tires and don't miss a shift, Jeff Hammond.
Well, as you guys have been speculating all afternoon, who's going to get tires and who's not? And it's going to be real interesting here, because you know this, as soon as you don't come, you're going to look in that rearview mirror and the guy behind you is going to come in pit road. And
one thing he may have could have done during that caution flag is get that right front cool just a little bit. But I'm going to tell you, Tony really stretches.
Trouble! Oh, no. I've seen this act before.
Jeff Green.
All right, the caution is out. This probably will be for the race coming to the line. Jeff Green in the one car.
That's a shame. He was running so well.
Yeah, he crossed the line in seventh last time, Darrell.
I think that dirt bank back there and the guardrail change has done its job. That's a lot better than what we saw here last time.
Well, all right. Mark Martin drove it into turn three that time. This is for the win. This will be the final lap at speed, and Tony Stewart leads into the flag.
Now, there's no way we can get this race restarted. That's lap 198.
The red flag window was 4 laps to go. Greg Biffle in trouble coming across the line in the 16 car, somehow in turn three.
I wonder if Biffle in the one car may have made some contact.
Somewhere Biffle got into the back of somebody. And so Tony Stewart will follow the pace car. And Mike Skinner's fine run on the lead lap for Larry McClure. And that one's going to end up in the grass.
Yeah, so it's a shame, because Jeff Green, Skinner, those guys were having good days, but that's what happens when you get a late restart like this.
Yeah, Greg Biffle, he was the only rookie left on the lead lap having a good run.
And here's what happened. Terry Labonte with a run.
Ooh. Pictures tell the story right
Boy,
there.
Boy, Terry, what was that all about? I know Terry.
Wow. That was a hard hit.
That was a hard lick. And it didn't look to me like Jeff Green was doing anything erratic. You know, it wasn't like he cut him off.
right in the middle of the straightaway.
Boy, that's so uncharacteristic of Terry, but like you say, the pictures tell it all.
Boy, Jeff Green lucky he didn't slide back up in front of traffic.
Here they come. They're all the way up on the straightaway, and you can see.
Oh, they both? They were dropping low.
Silhouetted each other.
Well, I'm going to tell you, as I watched that one car go across that grass, that is a mirror of 11 months ago with Steve parking that car in that same area, hit almost the same place.
Boy, that opening right there, though, that's a hard hit.
Let's show you what happened 1 year ago, just what Larry's talking about.
Yeah, this was at the beginning of the race last year.
Watch how much the guardrail moves now without that dirt behind it.
See Rusty Wallace in the one car get together, and then here comes Dale Jr. pushing Park, and the car goes absolutely berserk and turns over and flies apart.
There were two issues there, as you saw Dale Jr. a year ago go to Steve Park's aid. Darrell, one is you didn't have that dirt backing the guardrail. The other was the spacing of the guardrail posts were kind of far apart. And here's what just happened to Jeff Green. Ian Labonte moved down.
In almost the same area of the racetrack.
Gosh, and wouldn't you know it's right where the opening is. Yep.
Jeff Green is out of that car. He is okay.
Boy, that had to hurt.
And we need to mention that our field just took the one to go along, of course, the white flag with the yellow flag, so they are on the last lap. They're over on the Long Pond Straight right now, right over in that same area.
Mike Skinner has climbed from his car. Also involved in Greg Biffle continues to go around the racetrack. There's Mike in the yellow Kodak uniform. And Greg Biffle is going to try to complete the final.
Find somebody that really will pick up.
One car around, takes one with it.
Here we go.
Schrader again and Ricky Rudd. I say again, 1 week ago we weren't 10 laps into the race and Ken Schrader had crashed in turn one.
I was just going to say, you really hold your breath right now in these early laps because the track's dirty, it's slick, your car a little loose. You can get turned around in a hurry.
Two cars. Now stop between turns one and two. Ricky Rudd against the wall in the Wood Brothers Ford and Ken Schrader climbing out.
And Jimmy Spencer in the seven car, he had all four wheels locked up to keep from getting into this wreck.
Schrader doesn't look all that happy the way he's snatching things off there.
No, there was contact well before the spin, Darrell. Let's see.
He's in the middle right there. Oh, he's in trouble. He's up in the middle. He gets forced up into Ricky.
By Steve Park.
But three wide going in the first turn on the second lap, I don't recommend that.
Here's another look. From Ricky Rudd's car.
Definitely just a victim on that deal.
And let's watch from Mike Wallace. Remember 1 week ago, Pocono, Kenny lost his brakes and piled hard into the wall.
And that was on lap seven. This is on lap two. So he's run nine laps in the last two races.
Steve Park, Ken Schrader, Ricky Rudd to get together, and caution is out early from Michigan. NASCAR Winston Cup Racing on Fox is presented by Old Spice. Spice things up. And brought to you by Chevy Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. By Burger King, we'd love to put a flame-grilled original Whopper on for you. And by Singular, the wireless company that fits you best. Welcome back to the Sirius 400 at Michigan International Speedway. Under caution at lap number two, Ricky Rudd and Ken Schrader are okay. After a hard crash at turn one on only the second lap. And Schrader explaining to Ricky Rudd what happened.
Now, I'm pretty sure Schrader's going to say the 30 car had something to do with this.
Well, let's see if, folks, if we can explain it to you and keep an eye right there on the gap between Steve Park and Kenny Schrader.
They're going down the first turn. Remember, they're going 200 mile an hour right here. 30 car looks like he doesn't really hit Kenny, but he forces Kenny up, and there's not enough room there between he and Ricky Rudd, and they make contact. Now, like I said, I don't recommend three wide racing down in the first turn this early in the race. So I'm waiting for one to hoot. So what do you think?
Ken Schrader, two DNFs in 2 weeks. What happened today?
We ran out of room. I was beside the 30, and Ricky shot the gap to the outside. And, you know, everything's real tight down there. And I guess I think the 30 got into me just a little bit, and I got up into Ricky, and we just all run out of room. I mean, it took three of us to do it, but we did it.
We saw you talking to Ricky on the racetrack. What'd you have to say?
Well, first off, I wanted to make sure he was okay, main thing, because he, you know, didn't just jump right out. But you don't know what happens in those things. You know, you got an idea what happens, you know. When it's just a couple of you, you almost know for sure. But when there's another one, someone else involved, you don't always know. So the main thing is he's okay, that's all.
As we near the restart, what happened to you?
Well, I think Kenny pretty well said it. I guess we ran out of room out there. You know, I was all up square with Kenny, so I knew that he saw me and wasn't going to be a problem going down in turn one. I got plenty of room. And evidently, Kenny must have got hit from the inside, because next thing I know, I'm going backwards in the fence. And it's just Shane, his Motorcraft Air Force Ford. It tested really good yesterday in practice. And the only good thing that came out of it, Schrader grabbed a hold of my Hans device, and I found out there's a whole lot lighter Hans than I've got. So a bad day, that's the only thing that was learned good. I guess a good thing is nobody got hurt.
Ricky was second 2 years ago. Mike?
Tough break for Schrader.
I said Kevin Harvick has looked in several races in that Goodrich car.
Whoa, Newman!
That
is a big-time engine explosion right there, big time.
He needs to get that thing woed up and get out of it. That's oil fire is what that is.
Get under the bottom.
And you see he's still running well over 100 miles per hour with the engine not running.
You can't see.
Right there. There's a fire truck right there.
Boy, great job by the spotter to guide him to safety.
That was a good job.
You can see all the oil running out from under the car. That's what's burning. Inhaling all that smoke and not being able to see is the tough part.
So John Erickson.
John Erickson.
Yep. He's the general manager at Penske and has worked with Rusty for a long, long time since moving over there. He used to work for Pontiac Motor Division, and he is on the horn with Ryan and got him right to the right spot.
And Ryan had the presence of mind to not jump. You can't just slam on the brakes. Got all that oil coming out under the tires. You jump on the brakes, you're going to spin the thing out and back it up in the fence. Then you are going to be in big trouble.
Coming off turn two, halfway down the backstretch.
There she goes. I just don't know how these guys week in and week out turn these things 92 plus, 9,200 RPM plus every week.
Now here's where Erickson's role is so important. We all know that the safety equipment can't move until the cars come down to pace car speed and have taken the caution flag. So he directs Newman to the fire truck.
Did you see the fire up inside the car? I mean, as we were looking at that, the whole right side of the car is engulfed in flames. Look at the dashboard in that car. Buddy, now, that's getting hot.
Now, pretty much all of our leaders are coming to pit road. This caution really, to me, is a big break for Tony Stewart, Michael Waltrip, but their strategy paid off because looks like Tony Raines in the 74 car.
And that'll bring out the caution for the eighth time today.
Just what Bobby Labonte, I think, probably is glad to see. And probably some of these guys that stopped and got tires are really happy to see this.
Yeah, it appears there's a few cars attempting, but nobody will get a lap back.
Timmy Johnson's up there. He was in touch, but not close enough.
Tony Raines' wounded car heads toward pit road as he brings out the eighth caution flag today.
Ties a record for the June race as far as cautions.
Tony been doing some three-wide racing. I saw him caught in the middle a couple of times down here going into turn one, so caught up with him.
It'll be what NASCAR calls a quickie yellow. That means all cars are eligible to pit first time by, and then we go back to greens. We'll be right back for that.
Marlin and Dale Earnhardt Jr., they can...
Oh, there he goes. Todd Bodine.
Oh. Hate that.
We have no caution yet.
Pieces coming off.
Tony Stewart would love to see a debris caution right now, and I think he...
Yeah, Todd just went up and hit the wall and turned.
He's going to get it.
Caution is out. Caution is out. That's a shame for Todd and that group.
Plenty of time to get this race restarted, but... All right, Jack Roush. Cheering on Kurt Busch. He has five cars in this race. Kurt Busch was the only Ford to qualify among the top half dozen. And it's been a tough weekend for the Bodines.
These three guys right here, Todd, Michael, and Mark, have really been racing hard. Todd got, you saw the car wiggle just a little bit. He was trying to keep it down under Michael, and when he corrected, there was nowhere to go but into the fence. Now he goes down here, and the steering's all locked up, probably got the right front tire down, and he's still going, still carrying quite a bit of speed. Just see that little bit of, he's trying to stay off of Michael, and when he turns it, it just gets loose with him.
He almost had it corrected.
Down on the inside again. You come up, come up, come up. You need more room. You don't have it.
If Michael had gotten back, you heard Michael's engine. If he'd gotten the back in the gas a couple of tenths slower, he'd be in it.
Not sure why Jack Roush is clapping, because that's going to put Bob.
You go to turn three, it also has a problem. And I believe the 74 car, Tony Raines, right there, has a flat right rear.
Yep, and Tony Raines is in trouble with that flat tire. And let's take another look at what happened earlier with Tony Raines in the 74 car.
And you can see right, he locked it up right there. He kind of slid it off the course right there, and probably that's where he knocked it either off the rim or cut it down when he got off the race course.
And we had not had a caution up to that.
Problem for Dale Jarrett. This is turn four.
He just overcooked that turn big time. It's almost like something happened, Larry.
Let's go on board.
He's coming downhill here, and it's very deceiving. Oh, hear that? Bop, 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 bop. Wheel hop. I knew something had to happen.
And that's caused a lot from a lot of rear brake, along with, you know, right after that restart, Kevin Harvick started really making some move on Robbie Gordon. Now he's starting to lose some ground. We see Christian Fittipaldi, he's off the racetrack. He was already a lap down, back in 42nd position. All the cars are still out on the racetrack.
Local caution there. Is he going to make it back on, or there's Joe Nemechek getting past Kurt Busch.
Pass for 10.
Nope. Fittipaldi is going to park it.
He's either in trouble or lost.
That's exactly right. That's what I was thinking, Larry. I was going to tell him, don't go back that way. Larry, you got to keep telling me now that this strategy is going to work. Whoa, the 18 is around again. Not a good day for number 18.
Bobby Labonte, a spinner for the second time today.
All charging down in here, and somebody charges in a little too hard. And
Wallace in the 23.
Exactly what happens. I mean, you know, one guy gets slowed down, one guy doesn't.
And he has to sit there and wait for the whole field to go by where he can get back on the race track.
Now, here's Kenny Wallace trying to send it hard into turn 11 to get side by side there.
Yeah, Ed Kenseth to his outside, and he just kept, you know, drove in pretty hard to be sure he got past Kenseth. Problem was, made it by seven.
Darrell, we see this. Oh, boy, Jack Sprague and Steve Park at turn seven.
Caution is out. Caution is out.
Yeah, I killed it on the right front. Did that.
They were back there battling for about 33rd position. Both of them still on the lead lap.
Leader has taken the caution, and both of those cars are pretty well used up. But Darrell, that pass for the lead, we see this time and again on a road course. Two cars go into the corner side by side. They're each trying to stay off of each other, each trying to win the corner but not upset each other, and somebody times it right and drives right under and past him, and that's just what Ron Fellows did.
Yeah, Ron was sitting in the perfect position to watch the whole thing and take advantage of it.
That was the catbird seat.
Yes, it was. Oh, the 38 cars.
Gets into Kyle.
Taking Kyle around. Here comes Tony Stewart. Todd Bodine going by, and then all of a sudden Kyle.
Oh.
Drove right in front of those guys. Jack Sprague had to check up. Steve Park had nowhere to go.
Yeah.
And now you know the rest of the story.
There's always the rest of the story.
And more to it, right? Now, DW, you have to believe in me. I'm still about 12 laps shy of my window.
Sell me,
keep
baby.
Keep those tires cleaned off because everybody's going to stay out with us at the front of the pack. We're not going to pit.
Sell me, man. Sell me because I'm wanting to come and pit.
Now, let's watch this whole thing unfold up here at turn 7. There's Elliott Sadler hits Kyle Petty. Kyle spins around, grabs himself a gear, tries to get going again.
Boy.
Oh, boy.
You know, that's just, it's almost as if Kyle's view was restricted, his vision was restricted, and he didn't see those guys coming. Like maybe his headrest and everything was up.
Coming up the hill at turn number 10.
Actually, I think that's up here at turn 2, Mike.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, coming up
turn
the hill.
Two, excuse me.
Turn 2. And that's so easy to happen. You slow down a little bit more than the guy in front of you slows down a little bit more than you do, and you get into the back of him. Coming around here, coming around. And
that was Kyle Petty got in the back of Jamie McMurray, who got into Mark. And then Mark gets off the road again, coming down the hill. Jimmy Spencer making a pit stop. Well, let's show you what brings the caution out. And it is debris all over the track. Rusty Wallace got turned around. And here goes Dale Jr. Cones flying, dust flying.
I heard Rusty say he thought he was having a brake problem. I heard him say he thought he smelled brake fluid, possibly having a brake problem in the front. So that may have added to that problem. Looks like Rusty's around way early, almost like he may have gotten booted coming up over the top of the hill back there.
See from his onboard as he was coming down the hill toward turn 4.
So Rusty went from about 6th or 7th back to 33rd, and then Dale Earnhardt Jr. went from 9th to 32nd.
That would not make me very happy if someone did that to me right there.
And see what happens with Junior here.
You know, it looked like
he checked up and got booted.
Yeah. Man, I'm going to tell you something. And that sounds serious. Trying to avoid an accident, and I tell you, it didn't. Here comes more cars.
Oh, three wide. That can't work.
Won't work. It did work.
Silhouette.
There you see Dave Blaney and Bob. Look at them stacking up behind them.
Like I said, big and ugly.
Synchronized spinning. No caution. No caution.
I give him about a 10. Well, I don't know, 9.5. I give him a 9.5 on that.
Well, that was ugly. Ricky Rudd and our point leader, Matt Kenseth, got through it. Now, no yellow flags as yet.
Yeah, poor old
Dave Blaney's in trouble.
Blaney.
He's got a flat tire.
Blaney's got problems.
Here come two of our leaders to pit road.
You know why they came to pit road? One, they're in their fuel window. They thought the caution was going to come out as well. If you're on pit road and the caution comes out, it's a free pit.
It may come out yet, Larry, because the 77 is just creeping down the back over here.
How about it, Dick Berger?
Now, Kevin Harvick has had a terrific run all day, and the last piece of plastic covering his windshield has just been removed. They're going to fire four at it. He needs a little bit more forward grip coming off the corner, but probably every other driver here does as well. Another flawless stop for Harvick. He's gone.
And then Kevin Hamlin yelled in the radio, pit, pit, pit. Robbie Gordon having trouble with the forward bite and air pressure adjustment to try to fix that race car. Robbie Gordon trying to win his first road course race in Winston competition, and it's going to be a drag race.
It is Harvick, the first of them off pit road. Ricky Rudd also pits, so does Jimmy Johnson, Greg Biffle, Michael Waltrip, and Blaney does make it onto pit road, but the left front of that car is junk. Darrell, three cars into that. They call it the butt bottleneck, and for good reason. That just won't work.
Yeah, I kind of felt like something like that just might happen, you know? They're just back in the pack back here. You get everybody real aggressive, and look at that.
I mean, I've never seen anything like
that. You couldn't do that any prettier.
Look at Ryan Newman in the 12. He barely gets by.
And who was just bragging on Dave Blaney keeping his nose clean not seconds ago?
It was not of his making.
No, no.
It wasn't me. It wasn't me. I didn't do it this time.
He was a victim. Well, that sure shuffled things up, and we have not had a caution as a result of this synchronized spinning. Show you what Michael Waltrip saw of all this.
He came to pit road, Michael did, so I'm not sure if he had damage or not, or if he's just in that fuel window.
Yeah, the guys at pit, there you see Michael Waltrip just stopping. Is Michael Waltrip, Greg Biffle, Jimmy Johnson, Ricky Rudd, Kevin Harvick, and Robbie Gordon all came to pit road at lap 66 with 44 to go. Bobby Labonte's on pit road as well. Dick Burton.
Just talked to Todd Berrio, crew chief for Happy Harvick, and he said they are all done pitting. I wanted to be sure, so I asked gas man Brian Englehart, and he confirmed, unless something untoward happens, they are all done making their pit stop. And just now, Berrio has come on the radio and told Harvick, pick your spots, be smooth. He could win this race with this strategy. Matt.
And Dick, that's exactly what Kevin Hamlin just told.
Just prior to the caution flag coming out.
Kyle has had a very eventful day.
Yeah, it's the same place, man. We've seen trouble just about all day there. Kyle's obviously his car. I don't think Kyle's very happy with Scott right now, based on what I'm seeing.
Here's a look at the incident that brought out the caution. Christian Fittipaldi locked it up and backed it into the tire wall at turn 10.
Looks like possibly Ryan Newman in the 12 got in the back of him there.
And here you just don't have a caution flag and gather up and get going for a set. You know, this race stays green. You've got to gather it up, and you find yourself half a minute or so behind.
Right in front of these guys, though.
Three wide, and it didn't work again. Nemechek and the Burton brothers tried to go into turn 11, three abreast.
And they were battling each other for seventh.
Well, here comes the one car, and who else? Here comes.
Here comes Boris.
Here comes Boris. I think it's Jimmy Johnson.
Gets about out in front of that group. Right.
Yeah, Jeff's going to go back from about 7th back to about 12th. So he didn't lose a lot of ground.
But that puts Sid right on the back bumper of Burton for 12th. Here's what happened. Three abreast.
Just in way too hot. Way too hot. Entrance too fast for conditions.
Got a car real slow down through this. Here it's the 66 car. I think he'll make it back. It looks like he's on a coast, though. Boys, right here comes the leader.
We're hearing that the engine blew up on that. Hit road.
There he is.
That's pretty
sure.
And Tony Raines has spun.
Caution is out.
Here's the race back to the line. Sed and Fellows. Behind them, Mayfield and Biffle. Oh, boy!
Good grief.
Tough break for Ron Fellows.
Man, he got the caution he needed to get him closed up.
He passed all those cars.
Passed all those guys, and he gets booted coming to the caution.
Digging there.
He had moved up to 13.
He's on the end there. Clear right there. 19 spun him out.
Yes, he did.
And let's see what happened to Tony Raines. I think he had a little help.
Yeah, he had a lot of help. Man. You see that entrance that Ron took to
he
that
kept
corner?
It out wide, but
that's
he?
A road racing entrance. That's the way road racers enter a corner. They make that late turn in to get the best, that gives them the best exit. The problem with
if
these,
nobody's underneath.
Yeah, the problem with the way we race, if you open that door, somebody's going to come through it.
See, he's going to go from 13th to 19th after that spin.
Now, Jeremy would call that casual contact, and Ron Fellows would be saying, oh, what'd you do that for?
Right.
Second, here's what happened to Joe Nemechek.
Got in too hot, turn seven. Of course, he was running in about the third or fourth position on the racetrack.
Ron Fellows trying to get back on track and climb back up through the field. Here comes Kenny Wallace.
Kenny done itself much more damage than he did to Ron Fellows, though, in the one car.
Yeah, well, he spun him out there a little while ago. I think at the end of the day, when Kyle goes home, he goes, say, between him and the Christian, they have done some spinning out today. Well, got a little help.
Definitely that motorcycle ride's going to do Kyle good, relieve his frustration from here.
And Jeff Burton ran out of turn 10.
Oh, this is ugly here now. He gets off and, man, this ain't.
He was running in the 11th position right then.
But he drove it back to the pits. Watch for Michael Waltrip. Burton gets loose, and as he corrects, he runs out of pavement.
Yep. Michael had to run off a little bit.
I used to get runs quicker, sooner, faster. Now they're coming less frequent, but we still get them.
We got a big one.
Oh, that's not good news for some of these guys. Good thing I quit early.
It hasn't turned into a big one.
I'll tell you what, that was.
But it could
I don't
have
think anybody hit the wall on that deal. That's unusual for this place.
That's about four loops around for Jimmy Johnson.
His tires are flat. But.
All right, buddy, don't just get it into the garage. Don't drive it so we don't tear up the car anymore. Okay?
And you see all this area here. That's where he scrubbed the apron of the racetrack and has torn up the front bumper, front valence, whatever you want to call it.
Looks like his right front flat, Danny.
Right rear.
He said, what did he say? I didn't hit anything?
Yep. You heard Chad Knaus, though, not want any of those flat tires if he goes at any kind of speed to come apart and tear the fenders off that thing that they've spent so much time massaging. And I don't know if anybody else got a piece of it in the jam up behind him, but we'll check it out here.
I'll take a look here. Oh, he just lost it by himself there, coming out of four, BP.
And look at those cars right behind him.
Boy, they did a good
Sterling
job.
Sterling Marlin.
Boy, how did Sterling miss him?
Was that Sterling or Schrader? I don't know.
We'll take another look and be sure.
That's unbelievable.
I don't know if he maybe had a tire down first or not, but that was just pretty much all by himself. But
that's Schrader.
It looks like he may have had a tire problem there, because that's unusual to get loose like that there by yourself.
I wonder if the left rear was down.
Yeah,
because we could see the right side of the car. So
yeah.
Marty,
what he said on the radio, guys, what it said, it felt like a right rear went down. And he goes into the garage back here. The right rear is indeed flat. Now, that could have come from flat spotting the tires on the track, but he said he felt like the right rear went down.
Boy, that was close.
Yeah, well, usually when you have a tire go down, whether it's the left rear or the right rear in a place like this, you're not sure. You know it's one of the rear tires, but it's hard to pinpoint which tire. But I would definitely say that's what happened to him the way it goes.
Jimmy Johnson to start 11th in the Pepsi 400. Fortunately, no major damage there.
Yeah, he was about a 43rd starter there for a second.
Yeah.
If Schrader hadn't applied the brakes quickly.
And I don't think Schrader hit him, but it'd be good to have somebody down in the garage, get a quick look at Schrader's car, and make sure they didn't nick up any of the fenders on it.
Well, look at the bumper of 48 car, if we can see it. Looks pretty clean.
Sure doesn't look like he's been tagged by anyone.
And by the way, the green flag is back out on the track, and they're out making these final 5 minutes worth of practice.
Running second, the car is skatey. We got a spin on the track with Dave Blaney. Off turn two. Looks to be a one-car incident, and the caution flag is out for the first time in the race. Dave Blaney was running in 26th place at the time of his spin.
And it doesn't look like there's any damage to the car.
If he stays out of the grass, he's got a left front flat. That probably happened after he had the tires locked up on 180.
And that pavement. pavement that Blaney spun down into was a safety feature added here at the Speedway several years back. Before a spin like that, he'd have been in the grass and probably upside down.
Yep, you're right, because that pavement, at least the car stays flat when you're spinning on the pavement, but when you get in that grass and you get sideways on the grass, it usually hooks the wheels and you start rolling.
Well, the car starts bouncing up and down and gets air underneath it, and away it goes. Let's see if we can see what happened to Blaney as he came off turn two.
Way up there high, you can see him way up high. Got a little help, it looks like.
Yes, he did. A little nudge in the left rear from...
Tell who that was. Roof flaps are up, though, and that kept that car down on the ground.
And there's the pavement we were talking about.
Checks brake.
Guilty.
And turn two is a place where you find yourself pushing really hard, especially this time of the race. And if you're down on the bottom, the car will quit turning coming out there when you're close to another car. So Jack may have lost the air off in front of his car, which sent him up the racetrack into the left rear corner of Dave Blaney's car.
That happened in the NASCAR Busch Series race back in February. It happened a couple times.
Well, turn two. Is this the big wreck? Robbie Gordon, Steve Park.
See, Ricky Craven.
Is that Kurt Busch?
Kurt Busch sitting sideways across the track through the smoke. I'll tell you what, could have been a lot more cars involved. And the field comes back to the caution flag. The race slowed for a second time.
Now it was right there around 6th, 7th spot. No, Elliott was in fourth.
Tough break for Steve Park. He really needed a good run tonight.
They have. Yeah, that was Mike Wallace involved. There's Matt Kenseth, the championship leader. He made it through. Remember all the track position he lost last time, put him right in the danger zone for getting caught up in something like that.
Yeah. Dodged the bullet.
Got to be lucky to win one of those championships.
Yes, you do.
I'll tell you. Wow. Damage in front of Robbie's car. Front, back, side. Not everything but the roof.
Yeah, let's see what we got here. Uh-oh, we got somebody spinning down there.
Steve
right in front of Robbie. Is that Steve? No.
That's Kurt.
Kurt Busch.
And look at that. I mean, these guys can't even see where they're going. Guys got caught up in that deal, and a lot of it just there's nowhere to go.
Look at Terry Labonte come through, right through the smoke.
Biffle goes between two cars. Poor Steve Park. Car just spin up direct in front of him.
What was that?
Lost. And he didn't have a car close enough to really get the air off the spoiler, so it wasn't that.
I'll be really interested to hear from Kurt when he comes back from the medical center, because that was unusual.
And Robbie Gordon, no place to go. He's got his load as best he can, but...
And he gets hit.
Gets hit from Mike Wallace from behind. Hmm.
Now, we saw a little bit of this last night, the Busch race. We had some guys that cut their tires, and tires went down, and we saw some spin-outs like that. But fortunately, last night, they didn't collect 10 or 12 cars. All those tires all look up.
Go on board with the singular car, Robbie Gordon. Listen to one.
Clear low. Clear low. Clear low. Inside out. I left in my ass right here.
Yes, he did.
That was Tim Overby, the spotter for Robbie Gordon.
And it's easy, you know. You say, why didn't he go low?
What?
You get down on that apron like that. you're going to tear your car up.
At 180-something miles an hour, you can't just hang that left turn necessarily.
Right, so he figured he'd stay there, and hopefully that car would disappear in front of him. What's going on down there, Marty? Can they tell us what happened with the 97 car?
Wally Kirk came on the radio right after the spin finished happening and said, the right rear went down on me. I had no control of the race car. The right rear tire is sitting in the back of Kurt Busch's pits. It is completely destroyed beyond recognition, so we'll never be able to know if there was a cut or what happened, but Kurt said it was the right rear just went down on him, and he lost control of the car.
Let's take a ride on board through this with Kurt Busch.
Well, let's see if we can... When they spin that fast, normally it is a tire going down.
What do you think, BP?
Yeah. That car went around pretty quick.
All right, guys. Got a big mess over here.
See Kurt's back on the track as he's been through pit road once already, but obviously Jimmy Fennig and the crew got some more work to do before they can get him.
Probably get down on that apron and move the fender on top of the tire.
Let's go back and check out that replay one more time and start a little earlier. See if we can hear a tire going down.
Yeah. You can hear the tire going flat.
Oh, that's ugly sound.
Thank goodness for replays, huh?
So, got seven cars involved in this. Robbie Gordon, Kurt Busch, Steve Park, Ricky Craven, Joe Nemechek took some damage, as did Jamie McMurray and Mike Wallace.
There you go.
There you go. Could have been a lot worse. Could have been 20 of them in that smoke and heat, just the same. Dale Earnhardt Jr. did not pit. He and Michael Waltrip are the top two in the Pepsi 400. Under caution. We'll be right back. At Daytona International Speedway, the Pepsi 400 under caution for a second time for a seven-car wreck off turn two. This is On Board with Jimmy Johnson.
Three wide, bud. Three wide.
All right, buddy. It's going to be one to go when you get around here. Clean them off.
Two wide. One. Oh, stay in front. Go low, buddy. Go low. Come on. Oh, yes. You're the man, buddy.
Yeah.
Awesome, Jimmy. Caution is out. Come on, baby.
Chris Osborne, a spotter. What a great job he did.
And I'll tell you what, all that pavement down there you're talking about earlier, Alan, I think there would have been a lot more cars in that wreck if it was grass. Watch all these guys drive way down on all that asphalt. You couldn't have done that if that was grass.
I mean, Jimmy Spencer just drove out of the picture going down on that pavement.
Dave Burns.
Well, Alan, the only concern then for Jimmy Johnson, Waxman, there were two concerns. One is he drove down in the apron, as you saw.
Last year, anyone there. Trouble turn one.
Derek Cope.
Boy, that looks like a tire may have come apart there on that deal.
Right rear. Yeah, because he crashed coming off the trioval. He wasn't even into turn one.
Yeah, no, I think he had a right rear let go. The way the right rear fender looks and the door and everything, that's definitely from a tire coming apart.
And the trouble with radial tires that they tell me that when they start going down, becoming flat, you can't tell it as quickly as you could the old bias ply tire.
Right.
And so the tire blows, the cap comes off, and you can see most of that damage was done by the tire, and then the wall fit to kill the rest of the car.
Tell you what, it's unusual though. Most of the time when a guy loses a tire, it's going in. You don't see these tires coming apart like that too often, you know, down the straightaway. But that's where you want it to come apart if it does.
Derek Cope scheduled to start 25th in the Tropicana 400 tomorrow. And yeah, that's a very, very weird place. The skid marks go all the way back down toward the start finish line. And so his problem started.
But he may have cut something. He may have run over something on the racetrack, you know, at the start finish line area.
Yeah,
and
see,
it just couldn't come apart.
Look at where the skid marks come off the wall. So that's where he hit the wall.
And look at all the debris in the back. All the debris behind where the skid marks were is where probably, you know, the tire initially came apart, which just passed the start finish line.
Derek's out of the car, carrying his Hans device. He probably won't look around and saying, okay, help me out here. What happened?
Well, Michael Waltrip is...
See the debris right there?
Yep.
Way before the tire marks.
Yeah, long before the contact with the wall.
That's too bad for Derek. Looking to make his seventh start of the season. Limited effort for a team that he is in ownership of. And now he's got a big repair bill after an unfortunate accident. Still under the red flag in NASCAR Winston Cup final practice here at Chicagoland Speedway while they attempt to load Derek Cope's mangled machine onto a rollback and also clean up the bits and pieces of metal scattered all the way from the start-finish line towards turn number one. So most of the cars back in the garage getting some adjustments and taking advantage of the opportunity for a little crew chief driver conversation. Let's check there now with Marty.
And let's check on the progress of Jim.
Flag moments ago and what might have caused this spin and crash.
That's definitely... loose.
I just think he's getting in the corner. And talking to the drivers down there today, Wally, it's the driver has to be so precise with the rear gearing and everything getting in the corner, and it's easy to get that car out of shape.
Yeah. Keep throwing that term loose around. How about we dive into the Home Depot virtual garage?
Here we go. Getting down on the corner. Now, if you watch the tires, when the green is good, that means green. All the tires are working the same. But when you see those tires turn red, that means they're not grabbing the racetrack, and the car wants to slide up the racetrack. It wants a fishtail. And that's what happened to Larry Foyt when he drove down into turn three. Those tires lost grip. And when you're losing grip, getting into the corner, as well as turning the wheels down to the left.
Around. Just after that last restart.
Oh, man, right rear tire on the four car.
Tearing that thing apart. Caution for debris.
And we know where the debris came from.
Third one of the race. Troubles for Johnny Sauter, making his NASCAR Winston Cup debut in Larry McClure's Kodak car this week.
It looked like they were struggling a little bit anyway.
And I tell you what, he was forcing to do that and not crash the car. Derek Cope did exactly the same thing yesterday, shredded a right rear tire and destroyed his car.
During Winston Cup happy hour, yeah. Mm-hmm. See the NASCAR official there telling him they can't go back out onto pit road until they make some further repairs. They were probably going to try and send Johnny around and keep him. Yeah, they're going to go behind the wall. Send him out, try and keep him in sync with the lap that he was on and try and make repairs with repeated pit stops under the caution flag.
Tony giving Buster on the pace car driver a little push.
400 is brought to you by Pontiac. Trouble turn two, Dale Earnhardt Jr. into the wall, caution flags out. Second place man in the NASCAR Winston Cup Championship.
And Junior has been having trouble the last couple of laps during our commercial break down in one and two. His car was very, very high, like something was wrong.
Big moment in the championship there for Dale Jr. Big moment in the race because the caution flag is going to bring some people like Jimmy Johnson a chance to get some fuel that they need to make the checkers. And that is going to be done for the day from the looks of that car.
Oh, no question. See if we take a look at what happened here. See him going down into one right there. Car is bobbling a lot right there, BP. Gets back in the gas and just loses it.
All of a sudden, the car just spins around.
But the car looked loose as he got down into one.
Well, you know, they've been talking about this car being a handful all weekend. And we caught just a clip at the end there of Junior's radio transmission saying, I just couldn't hang on to it this time.
Well, you know, in final practice, we rode along with the eight car a bunch of times, and that car really looked unstable getting into the corners, even then.
Try over
right there. Boy, when it happens fast.
Get some perspiration out of his eyes.
The car was real. Turn three, Bobby Labonte hard into the wall.
bottom of the racetrack to the top.
You got the yellow.
And Bobby Labonte has the wind in that down. He's trying to get out of that car.
So hard getting out with all that equipment on.
See Kyle Petty stopping to see if Bobby needs assistance.
And he doesn't. He's out of there. Man, oh man.
We've been seeing a lot of fire lately, haven't we?
That car just spun like a top. It's like there was oil or water or something up in turn three. Couldn't believe how quickly that car went around.
There is one other car involved in the crash, Mike Wallace, whose car has come to rest maybe 60 feet farther down the racetrack from where you're looking at Labonte's smoking machine.
Oops. Not quite out yet, fellas.
Well, it just came off pit road with a full tank of fuel. There's Mike Wallace out of his car. Good to see.
They better stay on that thing.
Yeah, they've got some stuff that's real warm there.
Good to see Bobby walking away from the car.
So is Mike.
But boy, a hard crash. I mean, I looked up, he went from the bottom of the racetrack to the top backwards and hit the wall a ton. So caution is out with 52 laps to go in the race. And let's see if we can go back and figure out what happened that caused this big mess in turn three.
There you see the 18 car.
There's Mike Wallace, they're side by side.
Mike didn't see him there.
Okay, oh. Benson drives into the 41. But they look like they save it.
Johnny's tire's bent out.
The racetrack, yeah. And he clips the 18 car.
Okay, that's why he spun so abruptly.
Yeah.
And Johnny made contact with the 41. It looked like it bent the suspension because you could see the tire in the 10 car just turn. And look at that hit. Oh, my goodness.
Seven cars got a bunch of damage also.
Looks like Steve Park in the 30 and maybe Bill Elliott. I saw Elliott spin, maybe Steve Park as well.
On board with Jimmy Spencer now for our next look.
Everybody checks up. Jimmy gets down right all the way at the bottom of the racetrack.
That was Steve Park that went around in the 30 car.
I saw some damage on that 7 car.
Jeremy Mayfield.
Way to do it. Drive at it. It'll be gone by the time you get there. Most
you
of
hope.
The time.
Yeah.
I can't believe they're
still trying to
put that thing in. What?
Yeah.
He had to pull his radio wire off. That's what he was hung up on when he was getting out of the car.
And he's so angry. He may be banged up, but he's so angry because all of a sudden just that almost threw Tony Stewart. 20 car goes in the corner. Ooh. Just drives right through.
Barely
along with several other cars.
And Jeff Gordon just following Stewart through. So a hard crash for both Bobby Labonte and Mike Wallace. Look at the damage to that car. I really didn't see how he got turned up into the wall there.
Army, the usual sponsor, USG this time. Chicago.
So what a twist in the championship this thing's taken in the last few laps. First, Dale Earnhardt Jr., the second place man in points, crashes over in turn two. Now Bobby Labonte, the fourth place man in the championship, crashes in turn three. But both Matt Kenseth and Jeff Gordon get through the incident, the first and third place men in the standings. Robbie Gordon on board. Yep.
In front of you. Check up, Robbie. Stand in front of you. Go way low, way low.
That's way low down in the grass.
You're all right.
But he got away okay. Under caution here in Chicago.
Back with you at Chicagoland Speedway. Big wreck in turns 3 and 4. Dale Earnhardt Jr. involved in that. Junior, you came out of the medical center on your own. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. We just we had the car too loose to drive it, and lost control of it. That's unfortunate, but same hands full.
And you were in a wreck earlier today, too, in turn 2. It was a long day. That's the same wreck we're talking about here. What was the condition of your car when it happened, Junior?
Oh, man, it was out of control. I think I may have had a flat tire, but I just pitted 3 laps before that, so I think we just over-adjusted, and I wasn't going to make it another corner, so it just too bad, but, you know, I can handle it.
All right, we're glad you're okay.
All right, thanks.
Alan?
All right, Dave, thanks, and Dave will get us an update on Bobby Labonte and Mike Wallace from the Infield Medical Center as well. Here are the drivers that got at least a piece of that. Up in turns 3 and 4, obviously Wallace and Labonte with the biggest roles, along with Johnny Benson. But Elliott Park, Gordon, and Mears all getting nicked up in that latest crash. Now, on pit road, when the pit lane was open just a moment ago. Well, turn 1, Casey Mears into the wall. Caution is out with 34 to go. Casey Mears was running 14th.
And Johnson just barely beats Michael Waltrip back to the line to take over third spot.
And the field will slow for a 7th time today. And Michael is expressing some displeasure to Jimmy Johnson.
But you know what? That's a good move on Jimmy's part, because as hard as it is on these restarts, as far as you can get up on the outside line, the better you are.
Here we can see Michael again, voicing his displeasure with his hands.
You, sir, are not a gentleman.
The gentleman move right there, about 48.
The gentleman's agreement, something that's been much discussed since Robbie Gordon's pass on Kevin Harvick, coming back to a caution flag at the Sonoma road course race a couple of weeks ago.
Here we come, back to the caution flag, and it's
Jimmy Johnson
by 5 or 6 feet. Enough to take over second.
Down into the corner. You want to get on the brake. Uh-oh. Trouble turn 1. John Andretti.
1 and 2. Car's up against the wall. You're coming to the caution.
And Johnny Sauter also involved in the 4 car.
And the first yellow is out as the leader completes the 9th lap of the race. John Andretti was running in 34th position at the time of the crash.
And that doesn't look very good when the car will not roll, will not go forward.
Well, what happened?
Well, it's 7 car alongside Andretti. That's Jimmy Spencer in the blue 7. They go in the corner and make contact.
Now, it looks like...
Again, they make contact.
It looks like Jimmy lost it, and when he corrected into the car of John Andretti.
Early yellow flag in the New England 300 on TNT. Here's the Wendy's race menu. Next weekend, the race for the championship is at the giant Pocono Raceway. 2.5-mile triangle, some spectacular racing there. TNT at 12:30 Eastern Time. Then the Brickyard 400 at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the Watkins Glen Road Course, and the 2-mile Michigan track. That's our Wendy's race menu. The race for the championship continues on TNT and NBC. None of the leaders made pit stops. Still cleaning up John Andretti's accident-damaged car. We'll take a break and come back for the restart.
The 6 car, Sterling Marlin in the 40, Rusty Wallace in the blue deuce, and Jeff Burton, the 99 car.
Sterling.
Oh, Sterling, easy there, boy. 3 wide as Sterling goes up high.
5, 6, 7, 8 cars passed him.
Flat tire, more than likely. Or he's got something on Debrina. Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Flat tire.
Right front. So Sterling Marlin with troubles. He was running in 10th position.
Right, guys, right side.
Just hold your line. Hold your line. Yep, right front is down.
And that's going to tear up that corner of the car before he gets it back to pit road.
Yeah, there it goes. Now the yellow will come out.
And here comes the caution, which is great for him.
Caution's right. Out.
Stay on the racetrack. Take the caution flag. Stay on the lead lap.
I don't know. He's going to have to come in pit lane. No, he's staying out.
He's staying out on that rim.
Wow.
The tire can't do any damage because it's gone.
Yeah, the only thing he's in danger of now is grinding some of the suspension parts off.
Exactly, because here at the New Hampshire International Speedway, they don't use the interline.
Check it out, 65 miles an hour through the corner without a tire. He was up to 80 at one point.
Yeah. They don't use an interliner here, so that car is rolling on the rim and the bottom of the car, the cross member, and hopefully not the oil pan or engine.
All right, any leaders going to pit here? Survey says no. All the front runners going to stay out. First one to come in is going to be Mark Martin back in 10th spot, but most everybody on the lead lap is staying on the track. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Something going on there that Lee McCall and the 40 bunch are going to be very concerned about. All right, leaders coming to the opening of pit road. Will everybody stop?
Here's what happened to Sterling Marlin going down in turn three. He goes in the corner, the leader right behind him, and guess what? Right front tire goes flat. Into the wall he goes. All right, back to the pit road.
They'll be coming.
Oh, yeah.
Here they come.
The charge is on. Now let's see who plays that strategy thing Wally was talking about. Anybody get two tires?
Jeff Gordon. I saw 9200, and we got a spin.
Rusty Wallace. Into the dirt on the backstretch. Caution flag is out.
But you know, I don't think he's hit anything. And Biffle tried to get that lap back, but could not.
All right. All right. Buddy, do take you out. Eight car took me out, yeah. Get caught up, we'll come around here and get four tires.
He said somebody took him out. I didn't hear what he said.
I believe he said eight.
That's what I thought he said.
Mm-hmm. Now, a little gentleman's agreement, disagreement there. Jeff Gordon and Jeff Green. There we go.
Eight car right behind Rusty Wallace. And according to Rusty, got in the back of him coming off the second corner. On board with Dale Earnhardt Jr. We'll see as he comes off the corner and watch.
Junior came on the radio and said, hey, that was my fault, but I don't know what happened there. He said, Rusty just paused coming off a two for no reason. He said, apologize to them. That was my fault, but I don't know what happened or why it happened.
So caution is out for the fifth time in the New England 300 at New Hampshire International Speedway. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. One lap away from the restart here in New Hampshire. We talked a lot on Discover Card Countdown to Green about the gentleman's agreement. After taking the caution flag, leader Jeff Gordon slowed down, and the first two cars a lap down were Greg Biffle and Jeff Green. They came up alongside to suggest to Mr. Gordon that perhaps he should have allowed them to have a lap back there.
Never see Biffle in the 15 car goes up. They just touching the 24 car, say, and Jeff knows who's back there. Let me have a lap. And here comes Jeff Green, the one car, said, hey, man, back off. Let's get a lap back. But why should he?
He shouldn't. That 24 chose not to get the lap back. You don't get a free pass when the yellow comes.
Trouble off turn two, down the backstretch. Big jam of cars in the cloud of smoke. Mike Wallace is the one spinning in the 0-1. Everybody else is going to get through. Caution is out.
A lot of damage to the... Well,
let's check it out.
Ward Burton right behind Mike Wallace, and
it looks like Mike Wallace just lost it on his own there.
It's hard to say.
I don't know. Yeah, there is some damage on the bumper, but from that angle.
Ooh, just couldn't catch up with the steering.
He spun to the left, to the right, to the left, to the right. That's kind of an army thing there.
I got you.
Okay, thanks. One more look.
Hard to tell from that angle.
Yeah. The question is, did the 22 hit him before or after he broke loose?
Yeah.
This is Robbie Gordon's view.
It's not a very good one either.
No. You'll have a caution when you come to the stripe. Caution when you come to the stripe. Watch that 16 if he tries to get him.
No
Not many of the lead lap cars are coming onto pit road under this caution, so we'll take a break and come back to New England.
Now is the 19 car. Jeremy Mayfield's got a left front flat.
Well, he ran into somebody and the fin knocked the fender in on the tire.
And the caution flag is out.
All right, here we go. There's Jeremy.
Like somebody maybe ran into him.
The 19 car.
Oops. Todd Bodine there in 54.
Okay, that's not where the damage came from.
Marty, you got more?
Hey, guys, just real quick. He had been complaining about that left front rubbing for quite a while. They were contemplating coming in during green. They were going to leave him out for a little while longer, but those rubs just never seem to go away, do they, Wally?
No, they don't.
It's too bad for Jeremy.
Kenny Wallace and Jeff Burton.
Oh, no.
Bid for win number 5.
Which, and BP, when you've got guys that don't have tires in the front, some guys got 2 tires, the guy's got 4 tires in the back, that seems to always happen.
And we see Bibble trying to race
my right front tire.
See, I heard Kenny Wallace say he blew a right front tire while he got up into the 99 car.
There you go. So Kenny Wallace with big problems on the Stacker 2 car.
He didn't break. He didn't blow a right front tire. He broke something in the suspension in the right front.
Well, we're not sure if that happened after the contact or before.
Well, the tire looks up, though.
Yeah, the tire does have air in it.
Yeah.
Bad deal for Jeff Burton.
Well, how bad's the damage? The left front fender's wrinkled up. And he's got a rub on the right. Is that rear end knocked out?
Yeah, the rear end looked like the rear end is loose.
What a bad break for Jeff.
Let's see what happened, BP. See if we can pick him out first here.
Around the very bottom down there.
Can you see? Oh, yeah, something definitely broke.
Oh, yeah, see all the sparks coming out from behind the car before he shot up into Burton.
Definitely broke on Kenny Wallace's car.
And then Burton goes up and hits the wall with the left rear and the left front, so that's not good.
Jeff was just in the wrong place on that deal.
And Kenny Wallace was awfully glad Jeff Burton was there.
Yeah, because he didn't get in the wall because of it.
Well, I mean, losing a right front, that wall's going to come up fast.
Listen.
Jeff Burton was his safer barrier.
Yeah, come on.
Eight tires better than 4 to slow down.
So caution's out again.
Maybe just the rear's not broke on that car.
Just past halfway here at New Hampshire, Jeff Burton's got problems.
The New England 300 from the New Hampshire International.
About $190,000 goes each race. It's $10,000 if you lead in the points and win the race. Hasn't been won this year.
Yeah, that money put up by the series sponsor, Winston. Do we get the feeling?
I think we know maybe why the bumper came off now.
Mystery solved.
Man.
Everybody's been running into Rusty today.
Ooh, Tony Stewart goes up and hits the
wall. I can't blame that on Tony.
No. Jimmy Spencer looked like got around Rusty in the outside, and Tony tried to fill the hole, and Rusty wanted to shut that door.
And Tony Stewart had a pretty good run off of 4 here. Actually, he just got squeezed into the wall. I'm sure Rusty doesn't see it that way, but...
I wonder how much damage Tony did to his car when he made contact with the wall. To see all this stuff and see the bumper cover flying through the air.
Only lead lap car to pit here is Tony Stewart. You see he's got that white paint from the outside wall all over the right side of those tires.
Smoke coming out of that car too.
It's probably the left front fender where Rusty rubbed him all the way down the straightaway there. How about it, Bill?
Tangled up with in the pits here.
There we see Jamie McMurray there. Safety crew's over. Jamie has talked to his crew on the radio. We heard him say that he was okay. Tony Stewart.
Yeah. It was the 18. He tried throwing the gun.
Did the tire change him? He was walking funny. Did he get clipped by somebody?
Here's the crash. Jamie McMurray in the 42 car. And look down the straightaway, Wally. The car's... Something's wrong.
Yeah, we were watching them go down the straightaway. And as soon as he hit the brakes, That's when the car really got loose on him, and he hit the wall pretty hard here.
Watch Boom. This. And watch the bumper cover off the very back of the car.
Same thing that Rusty Wallace had knocked off a little bit ago. But he had brakes because the rear brakes locked up just before he hit the wall. If you watch the rear tires, you'll see them lock up.
The car's like shimmy.
Yeah, it's like...
Remember, he had reported in that he thought he had something wrong with the car. Maybe the left front was down.
It doesn't look like any tires were down, but it certainly, when he got on the brakes, all of a sudden the car got sideways on him.
Something broke. We just don't know why.
Yeah, because the tires are up there on the right side.
And the reason we couldn't break out of the commercial to show that to you while it was happening was because with the cable systems, we're in a local break, and we're not in control of that until the time is up. So we apologize for that mistiming.
Hey, Dave, can you give us anything on the 42 there?
Yeah, well, right after Jamie wrecked, first of all, the crew radioed to him if he was okay. He radioed back, I'm fine. And they talked a lot about the brakes, and it does appear that that's a problem he was having as he headed toward the wall.
Okay. I want to go back and see that the replay with Tony Stewart and Bobby Labonte again and wonder if that rear tire changer on the 18, see, he's limping when he comes away from the car, like, say something funny there.
Yeah.
That's he pulled a Charlie horse. He pulled a muscle in the back of his thigh.
Trying to get away there, yeah, something. We'll get that followed up on from down on pit road.
He tried throwing that gun in front of Tony, but he just didn't get it there fast enough.
Yeah.
Tony was in his pits in such an awful angle. They think they can make it.
That's the first spot. They're all trouble. Christian Fittipaldi, who was on the lead lap in 23rd position.
Now, that's going to help all those guys that thought they could make it, these caution flag laps. But Jeff Gordon is going to have to stop, and he's going to be mired way, way back in traffic on the restart.
Yeah, and that's the track position we talked about earlier. That's not going to help him. Almost impossible to get through all those cars.
12th caution flag of the New England 300, and by the way, the record for most is 17, so we got a while to go. Not out of reach, though.
There's a 43 car.
43's going to get a little help here, I bet.
Yeah, Michael Walter gets in the back of him.
It's been a rough couple of weeks. NASCAR Winston Cup racing for Christian Fittipaldi.
Let's go on board that Napa Chevrolet driven by Michael Waltrip, and we can probably see this.
Yeah, he was working the throttle there a little bit.
Yeah, wasn't just not enough. Right through him.
Yeah.
Have a right side front tire going
trouble
down.
Bell. Turn two, Mark Martin is in the wall. Sliding back in traffic.
Yeah, that's scary.
And those great race car drivers somehow missed him.
That's the worst feeling for a driver when he's sliding down the racetrack into oncoming traffic. You're just waiting to get hit again.
Caution is out.
Radiator's busted.
Third time in the race, and Mark Martin driving away.
Anything else? What else is hurt?
He said the radiator is broken, and that...
All right, guys, let's get the toolbox back to the garage. We're going to have to change the radiator and work on the left rear.
Or if that's what caused the spin, is water under the tires.
Well, let's just see, BP. Nope. I think contact.
Yeah, I think that's what...
Looked like him and Earnhardt Jr., and I think he got tagged right there. That's what did it. He saved the car after he got bumped by Earnhardt.
Michael couldn't get off.
Michael, yeah.
See, there's where the radiator damage came in. When the left front came around and hit with the outside retaining wall.
Ward Burton just got underneath Mark into the grass. Right along.
Inside.
Yep, he had it saved. He just got a little bump there from Michael Waltrip.
And you hear him trying to start it up right away as soon as he came to rest there. Mark going to the garage, joining Jamie McMurray and Derek Cope, who have taken their cars to the garage recently. McMurray with a transmission problem. Tough break there. He was running in the top five earlier in the event. Third caution is out on the Pennsylvania 500. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Eastern Time. Michael Waltrip with damage from that altercation with Mark Martin. Is on pit road to get that fixed. Here's a look from Mikey's view.
Michael didn't have too much he could do on that deal. He had nowhere to go.
Not much he could do about that.
Bill?
Well, Michael Waltrip on pit road now, working on the right side. They thought about just staying out, but then they decided to come on in and work on it. He's going to get four tires to pull the sheet metal away. Best quote from Michael. Gee, I was in the wrong place at the wrong time there. So they work on Michael Waltrip's car. They had just dodged a bullet. He had a left rear going flat on that previous caution. Back to Pocono in a moment.
Get gone and get out of the way so Michael can have...
Oh, trouble. Turn three. Jeff Gordon is in it. Caution flag is out.
That looks about like the dent.
Oh, he's got big problems.
Yeah, big problems because the wheel.
Pretty low over that right side, then, Jeff.
See, the left front wheel's going due south.
I can't go anywhere.
And the right front's going due west.
Second place driver in the NASCAR Winston Cup Championship lost some ground at New Hampshire last weekend when they took four tires on the last stop and couldn't gain back any of the lost ground. And now here today at Pocono, he's in the wall with 76 laps to go.
So we can see what happened to Jeff Gordon caused this. Never see Gordon on the inside.
Looks like he got a little tap there once from the 77. Oh, they just checked up in front of him. 43 of Christian Fittipaldi checked up in front of him. Jeff Gordon checked up. But the problem is when you're that stacked up and you're in that tight of traffic, you can't see too far ahead of you, and it looked like those guys just got in the back of him.
Yeah, just kind of accordion together.
Yeah.
On board with Kurt Busch. We can watch the wreck unfold and listen.
Been in front of you, buddy. Just stay right there. Come on. Come on. You're clear all around. Good job, buddy. Good job. On to south.
Yellows breed yellows. Is that what you say, BP?
Yeah, I'm telling you, do they ever.
So Gordon out of his car, make the trip to the care center for the mandatory checkup, and Robbie Loomis and company will jump on that thing, see if they can fix it, get back out and make some more laps. Yellow flag out on the Pennsylvania 500 for the fifth time here on TNT.
TNT Mondays. TV Guide calls it the best news show on television, and A, riveting. Television's best news series is now on TNT. Mondays at 10, only on TNT.
Under caution here at Pocono after Jeff Gordon's crash in the Pennsylvania 500, we check our Chevy leaderboard, and it's a pretty good day for the Bowties. Gordon accepted right now. Four of the top five, and another farther down in the top 10. Chevrolet's running very strongly today here at Pocono. Well, Robbie Loomis and the boys going to jump on that car, see if they can get it fixed and get Jeff Gordon back out. If things finish as they are now, he's going to lose even more ground to Matt Kenseth. He was 234 points down coming into the race. That's as they run. It would be only Jeff Gordon's third race in 22 tries that he's failed to finish here at Pocono. One of the pioneers of NASCAR racing was lost this week. Pioneer in a different way. Bob Latford was a publicist and historian of the sport. He passed away Wednesday after an illness. Latford was one of the early drum beaters for the game, getting out and turning out folks to the racetrack before there were more folks coming to the racetrack than there were tickets available. And he's also the man responsible for creating the system used to determine the NASCAR Winston Cup champion. It's a long story, but the short of it is he created it on a napkin in the Boot Hill Saloon in Daytona Beach. Bob Latford, we'll miss you. Caution has just come out. Casey Mears has just hit the wall in turn one. Seventh yellow flag of the Pennsylvania 500. Just before Mears hit the wall, Bobby Labonte, Jimmy Johnson, and Sterling Marlin were on pit road under green getting fuel, joining Kevin Harvick, who had done it a lap before.
Now all those cars that couldn't make it are going to have to stop. They can stop, but they've got to stop, start, restart behind all the cars that have stopped.
It'll be a race now. Don't have to worry about fuel mileage.
That's right.
So Ryan Newman comes back to the caution flag, letting Jamie McMurray have another of his laps back.
McMurray still six laps down to the race leader in 30th spot.
Here is where that track position is going to pay off.
Big time, yep.
See the safety workers there with Casey Mears. And he is out of the car.
Pretty serious damage to that target car. That right rear became a target, didn't it?
Well now, how about the 12th? Another yellow flag in the Pennsylvania 500. It has just gone into the air because Bobby Labonte first lost the engine and slid in his own oil into the wall in turn number two. Tough day for Joe Gibbs Racing. And the fourth place man in the championship is not going to have a good weekend here at Pocono.
Blew the engine, obviously, water and oil coming out of those pipes like they were on his teammate's car. Got on the rear tires and slid into the wall.
Not much you can do when that moisture gets on the speedway.
That's one thing, though. When you have a teammate out there and he blows up, you think about that for a long time. Like, oh, man, is that going to happen to me?
Yeah.
Now then, we're all back to the strategy thing.
Oh,
again.
Yeah.
We're back to this deal again.
Okay.
How many cars are going to stop?
Well, let's set up why they might, though. Now, we think that even people like...
Get a Carfax vehicle history report, ask your dealer, or go to Carfax.com.
Whoa, hang on. Boy, you saw that coming.
Larry Foyt in trouble. And in a lot of trouble to make the Brickyard 400 field. Because they are way down in owner points and the provisionals are not likely to get back that far. What happened?
He was way, way low on the apron right there. That may have got the car out of shape.
He had that little bit of a wiggle and just never could quite catch up with it. Another angle. There, that little wiggle. And he has to try to lead the car up to the racetrack to catch the back end, but unfortunately, before he caught the back end, the wall was there.
That was the beginning of Larry's second lap. His first lap.
That's a sickening
sound. And that's usually the deal here. Usually you're loose on the second lap here.
Tires start losing some grip.
Yeah, I mean, you could feel it, like I said, coming off of turn two.
Larry's first lap was only eighth fastest of the eight that have gone so far. So he needed something on that second lap. Bill, what he got, though, was not too good.
Not what he was hoping for, Alan. Down here on the wagon alongside pit road with Elliott Sadler, currently sixth. And you were watching that replay. What'd you see?
Yeah, just like Wally said, when you get under the white line in any one of these four corners, it's a lot flatter than it is on the rest of the track. And if you go down now, your car's got to be comfortable enough to go. And it looks like he just hit it with the left front too much, made his car wiggle. He tried to catch it, but it's just he ran out of racetrack a little bit there. Now you see, he's way under the white line right there, and that kind of unloads the car a little bit. It helps the car turn, but sometimes it'll do it too much, and just got away from it.
Help him. Trouble on the track, Alan.
It's actually on pit road. Dale Jarrett has turned around and facing the wrong way on pit road. Marty, what's up there?
The team actually chose this pit stall because they had so much room, but this morning they met together and told DJ it was going to be very tough to get to pit road. I talked to the spotter, Bob Jeffries. As you see Jimmy Johnson slide to a stop, we're trying to slow down a little bit. He said that was going to be DJ's toughest task. This is the first pit stall at the end of pit road. He had to get low down, then got spun around. Too much rear brake in the car, probably, wouldn't you say, Wally?
Yeah, that's especially if these cars are tight here, Marty. If you've got a tight race car, you're going to dial rear brake in to help loosen the car up. But you've got to remember that when you're making pit stop, because when you come down pit lane and jump on those brakes, you've got a lot of rear brake in the car, and that's going to spin you out.
The caution is coming out. The caution is coming out because of the situation on pit road involving Dale Jarrett's car. There is apparently a crewman down there, and they are putting the caution out so they can close the pit road.
I wonder if any of these cars, we've had cars.
We got the guy right. right there along the wall there that they're working on.
So the caution is out so they can close the pit road, keep any more cars from coming down, and move some rescue workers onto pit road to further attend to the injured crew member.
Good move.
So yellow for the first time in the Brickyard 400.
There's Phil Horton, the white guy in the white shirt, the pit crew trainer and also coordinator for the 88 UPS team.
And we'll obviously find out more details on the situation as soon as it becomes available to us and pass it along to you.
Yeah, that's just too much rear brake in the car right there. Man, that's a scary situation.
Oh, my goodness.
Look at the jack.
Look at the jack, and they went toward the, and the official just calmly, look at the damage to the
damage,
right front.
That's from hitting
the wall,
you get into the wall there, yeah. And when you're sitting there as a driver, you don't want to play anymore right now. You're feeling for that guy that's laying on the ground, your car's tore up, and your day is just about over. You're going to be a lap or two down, and that really, you really feel bad in a situation like that.
So again, pit road is closed, and the caution is out because of the Dale Jarrett accident in his pit stall. Further details as soon as we can get them. For now, you're watching NASCAR on NBC.
Room to get in there. Could have blocked it behind that car.
There's that caution flag. John Andretti, hard contact with the wall.
We just got turned and got the left rear. Left rear pushed down.
John was running 18th. Trying to get it refired and drive back.
Now this is what Robbie needed, and a lot of those cars needed big time to get back in the race.
So they need to get to the start-finish line and the caution flag in front of race leader Ryan Newman. That's Newman in the 12. And all those cars in front of him are going to get to come back around and make up 2.5 miles when the pace car comes out in front of the 12 car.
That's a free pass.
For 2.5 miles. Wow, how cool is that?
There's a lot of yoo-hoo going on in these race cars right now.
They're happy boys.
That's going to put 37 cars on the lead lap now.
The problem is, once you get a lap down, winning is impossible.
Almost here. You're right, BP.
So what happened to John Andretti?
He got turned, according to the spotter. And
yeah, they got bottled up. Looked like Matt Kenseth and Michael Waltrip were kind of bottled up down there. And 81 jumped on the brakes, and I didn't catch who.
74.
Tony Raines.
Tony Raines got into him.
So what started out to be a great weekend, John qualifying 11th for that Dale Earnhardt Incorporated car, had to drop to the back for an engine change. Now he's going to the garage.
Still more contact.
Blocking. Here comes Matt Kenseth. You can't do it four wide at Indy.
Robbie Gordon drives that car in on the outside.
Oh, McCurry got sideways. Took the air off McCurry's car. He got sideways.
Oh, Terry Labonte is around. Three, four cars in it. Ricky Rudd, Mike Skinner, Jimmy Johnson, and Sterling Marlin. Caution flag is out.
Is that Skinner? Skinner's in there, too.
And all of those cars that were in front of the leader just got 2.5 miles of free pass.
Sterling Marlin involved?
Like I said, it's a 20-lap featured Flemington.
Oh, man.
Joe Nemechek with damage. Car on the left, now on the right. And that's Mike Skinner in the Army car coming at you.
Not exactly. I guarantee you, Robbie Gordon is not going to say, oh, Kevin, go ahead and win this Brickyard 400. It will never enter his mind to let him win.
All right, let's go back and reconstruct what happened for you in the big jam of traffic in turn three.
See, the 77 car blaney'd very, very high, so obviously something had happened beforehand, and oh, man, this all starts there.
I think Terry got hit in the back to start that. Oh, look at that. Man. All four wheels off the ground.
Up in the air.
I think this all started from the result of McMurray getting sideways when Robbie Gordon drove on the outside of him going into turn three, and a bunch of cars checked up.
I'm not so sure that Dave Blaney didn't have a tire go down or something. because he kind of got out of the gas and got up out in that outside lane.
There he is, up the yellow car on the outside that Alan is talking about.
And Terry definitely got hit
a couple times.
Once to start it and once there. As Terry Labonte in the five. Ricky Rudd, 21. Good day gone bad in a hurry. Might have been Kurt Busch that got Terry Labonte. He was the one right behind him. 0-1 car, Skinner hit by Rudd in the 21. You see Nemechek got Sterling Marlin. Nemechek in the red and black car all caved in at the bottom. Far right side of your screen.
And now all of a sudden, these cars are coming at you.
This is Kurt Busch's view.
Clear, clear, keep digging. Got 77 up top there, come on.
Skinner.
Still there. Slow car ahead on the outside. Stay low, low.
Not a whole lot Mike could do there.
Ooh.
Well, he was almost through it.
He was. And low or high, either one, there was no place to go as far as Skinner was concerned.
The blade of grass stuck across the lens of the camera. Jimmy Johnson got a piece of this, too. On board with him.
And side. Man.
He might have spun out of harm's way.
Jimmy, you okay, bud?
This is Kevin Harvick's crew reacting to him coming by with the lead for the first time since lap 17.
And this is a hard place for the spotters.
Very difficult. We talked about it. Dave talked about it earlier about adding spotters. Very tough place for spotters to help the drivers here.
So the seven drivers involved in the accident that's put us under caution in the late going of the Brickyard 400. Fifth caution flag of the race. And so they're trying to push the Joe Nemechek car into the garage. He'll be done. Looks like Mike Skinner's headed to the garage. And the attrition rate that had been very low, only two cars retired from the race so far, is suddenly going to grow by a few. Kevin Harvick is leading. We're under caution with 14 laps.
This one actually feels a little bit lighter. The thing that amazes me about these, Wally, is they're not fabricated. They're cast.
Right.
These things are cast. And what a casting it takes to do this.
Red flag is out. Junior's found the gravel trap. Not too good.
Not too good.
And so practice stops here at Watkins Glen because they're going to need a minute or two to haul that car out of there. And his team's going to need about 30 minutes to shake all the rocks out of it.
Let's see what it looked like.
Now that's turn 10, second to last corner.
Too much, like I said, too much for a break. These guys really have to concentrate on getting their brakes balanced, especially at that corner right there. And turn one, I think, are the worst two corners for wheel hop.
So Earnhardt Jr. has put out the call for some assistance. Maybe OnStar will be coming to get him. I don't know. Red flag here at Watkins Glen. The crowd always gathers at the scene of the accident.
Is that the Three Stooges?
Yeah, it might be. Now, we know it's not the Pep Boys.
Hey, we're on, baby!
Watching as the rescue crews try to pull Dale Jr.'s car out of the gravel trap. And Junior trying to advise and make sure it doesn't get any worse damaged coming out of there. Yeah, red flag is out.
They're doing a pretty nice job. It's that front valence.
Yeah.
When it starts grabbing the gravel like a plow.
Was it here last year or 2 years ago that Dave buried himself in the gravel trap to show
what it was? Yeah, it was down in turn one, I believe.
So Earnhardt Jr., who has already posted the second fastest lap of this practice,
Maybe it may have seen the last of his track time here. As his crew's going to have some work to do to get the gravel out of all the different little brake rotors and suspension pieces. And
put about two turns of the front brake there, Dale.
There you go. Maddie, what you got?
Well, Alan, we spoke to Bobby Labonte earlier in the show. He's fourth quick, but his team
knew he did. I was trying to get Kurt to drive with me in the 24-hour next year. We're working on a deal there about for the next 24-hour, but maybe a manufacturer issue.
This would be out at the chicane, the bus stop, and the red flag is out for Kyle Petty having issues.
Yeah, you've got to hit that curb just right. Ooh, he did have some issues.
The big styrofoam blocks there, the softer barrier, if you will.
When you hit that curb, you have to let the car land and settle before you turn it.
Just make sure it's not bent up, and we'll go again. 10-4.
And it looked like Kyle was trying to turn it a little bit too early before the car settled. But when you launch yourself over a curb, you've got to let the car land. Count 1/1000 before you crank on the steering wheel.
Say, just to put the button on the issue of the road courses and whether they belong in Winston Cup racing or not, the thing that I like about it is the fact that it's...
Pull the fenders off if you can.
To win the Winston Cup Championship is a test of a driver's versatility. Just think about this next month. We went from Indianapolis, big, flat, high-speed, 2.5-mile track, Watkins Glen Road Course, High Bank, Michigan track, the Bristol Bullring. Going to win the championship, you've got to be good at all of those different types of tracks.
There should be just one more.
Uh-oh.
Remember that guy I said earlier didn't like this place?
Yeah, he's not liking it anymore today.
No.
Yeah. Jimmy
Spencer.
They got
to go back to where they had it. They took fuel out and they made it.
That's Tommy Baldwin there. He and Jimmy having a chat about things, obviously. Jimmy got off at the bus stop chicane yesterday and wrinkled up the left rear corner of that Dodge. And I believe that's the same spot he's in today, right?
Yes, yep. Sir. The thing that's tricky here, too, on this road course thing, Alan, is when that fuel does burn off, the brake bias is something that you really have to stay on top of. You have to understand how those brakes can be balanced during a road course race, because you'll hear a lot of guys talking about fuel loads here, mm-hmm. and that will get you in trouble so quick.
So you're adjusting it constantly from the cockpit as you run more laps and burn off more of that rear weight.
Yes. I don't think this probably was the issue with Jimmy, but again, a lot of these guys look like they're hitting that curb a whole lot more than they used to.
Well, you know, they go and they watch Robbie Gordon plow his car over the top of that in qualifying like that.
We'll be all right. Get a top 20 additive.
You just can't hit that curb and be cranking on the steering wheel. You have to let the car land. You have to keep the wheels almost straight. The car's got to be settled after you hit a curb.
Talking about some of Jimmy's problems previously in the weekend, here was the practice incident from yesterday. Same spot on the track. Left rear corner repaired. Then in Bud Pole qualifying yesterday, the pavement generally is faster.
Definitely.
So that was at the beginning of Jimmy's lap and sent him chasing things from there. Dave?
Kevin Harvick, three, how about four wide into turn one?
Oh, almost contact between the 16.
Oh, who's
there
around?
Was contact. Jeff Gordon, the leader. I think maybe he and Bimble will make contact, get him down in the corner.
Remember in New Hampshire, they had a little confrontation about Gordon and Bimble getting back on the lead lap?
Wow.
They said it was settled. Maybe it's just flared up again accidentally. Jeff Gordon has continued away. The track is clear. We stay under green. The inner loop, or the bus stop, as some people call it.
And if you get in that gravel pit, it becomes a rest area. Pretty deep rest area.
Here's the out. Oh, Kyle Petty in trouble at the inner loop. That's on the outside of the track, so he didn't even get through the corner. And he got stuffed into the styrofoam. Big.
Guys, the whole front right side rear. He's fortunate.
Full course caution is out as they complete lap one.
Let's take a look what happened down here in turn one. Yep, Gordon definitely got booted.
like that he was really slowed down at that point either. Getting through the corner pretty good.
Flat out on the gas to keep that thing from getting off into the gravel trap.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, he did a fantastic job in keeping that car, did not get stuck in the gravel. Like I said, you got to stay on the pavement, and so did Jeff Gordon. Never see.
Wow. Still there outside. Watch 24 spun. Clear all around.
All right, so that was the first end of the opening lap doubleheader. Now we go to the other end of the racetrack in the inner loop. Those four turns that Kyle Petty did not come out of successfully. Here it comes. Wow. Look at that.
And that's a slow part of the racetrack.
Yeah, I can't figure that one out.
Wonder if Sterling Marlin got
good.
No, that's not good at all, because the smoke, when it comes out the tailpipe like that, terminal. Matt?
Radio conversation between the team and Sterling. They've told him to take the car to the garage to see if there's anything they can do to try to fix the car.
So under caution very early here at Watkins Glen, two different incidents on the first lap of the race, including that one involving Kyle Petty.
Trouble on the front. There's a crash.
Off the final corner, it's Christian Fittipaldi, and the caution flag is out. You know, we don't have a warning track before you get to the wall here at Watkins Glen in most of these corners. Paint job for Petty Enterprises here, commemorative of the 100th anniversary of New York Yankees baseball, but the pinstripes did not fare well in their home state today.
No. He was trying to catch a long fly. He was trying to catch a long fly ball and right in the wall.
That was a good break for the four car of P.J. Jones and Scott Pruitt.
Look at the mess. Jeff Burton, now the leader, brings the field back to the caution flag, and yellow number three is out at Watkins Glen. What happened to Christian?
I want to say he got a little help.
Steve Park trying to get under Christian in the 30 car, and yep, a little bit of a bump.
You are right.
And Steve Park spun out.
And those big styrofoam blocks, the initial safer barrier put up here at Watkins Glen several years ago to really cushion a blow that a driver might take. That's a heavy impact.
Did his job well.
So under caution for the third time in Sirius Satellite Radio at the Glen, you're watching NASCAR on NBC. Back, Tony Raines has trouble. Junior takes the full course caution at the start-finish line, the fourth one of the race, while the 74 of Tony Raines is going to limp back around and head for the garage. He was running 35th at the time.
And Tony's going back to the garage area with a very, I think he's hot.
I would say he's hot.
Yes, he's hot, because something caused this, and he probably had some help in making contact with the retaining wall.
All right, here is the pass for the lead with Junior squeezing by Jeff Burton just seconds before we came back.
Comes off the carousel, gets him a good run to turn 10, gets on the inside and just simply outbrakes him and does the wheel up, just does it perfectly. Goes on in the front.
And the crash, Tony Raines, 74 car. Ooh, he and Terry Labonte hooked, look at that. Ouch.
Another shot. There we see Tony.
Not often you see him crash on the straightaway.
No, I was just going to say that.
What we have here is a miscommunication.
He was... One was going right, the other was going left, and...
You know, we got a good restart. Made to dive into turn one.
Uh-oh, Morissette! Trouble on the backstretch, and the whole field charging at him.
Oh, man.
Good job.
What a job.
He's putting me at the top of the S.
What a job by Morris.
The damage there on
on his left front corner.
Like you said, he
was running 10th at the time.
Bring it back, man. Nice and smooth.
And we stay under the green flag.
That's just amazing, the job that Morissette did there. Amazing.
Fender 2, left front fender.
So Boris coming to pit road and monitoring NASCAR's race control channel. There's some discussion about debris, and a caution flag would be much needed by Boris here to let him catch up to the pack if it were to come out. But so far, no yellow. 35 mile an hour pit road speed coming to Dave.
Seems like you're crawling, Alan. They said two left side tires only. Don't want to take the time to put on four. Try to pull away that damage on the left side if they can. So they'll just do the two tire stop now, pack the fuel cell full of fuel. This should not be within their window, guys.
Yeah, there's a lot of damage there.
Yeah, they got to get him going soon.
Sounds like he's got that tall first gear in it.
Fastest part of the track right here.
Yeah, it looks like
Robbie Gordon. Robbie Gordon's able to run the back of him and see all these cars getting by. Jeff Gordon goes by. Tony Stewart. Matt Kenseth gets by.
Championship leader. They see the yellow light flashing there. As we get another look at it, yeah, just clipped him. Robbie was probably flat through the S's, and Boris had to breathe it a little bit.
Yeah.
But the yellow light flashing there on a road course.
On board with Boris. There's a little bit of a bump.
Yeah, you're not lifting at that part of the racetrack, so you can hear he grabbed fourth gear already, so Boris was already flat in the gas.
Dale Jr. Oh, got a car off. Rusty Wallace in the gravel trap.
And in the mud.
Oh, look at that.
Is he stuck?
He's going to be stuck.
Yeah, he's stuck. He can't get out of there.
We're off in champ, Billy, but I don't think he hit him.
I'm in the bottom.
That's at the inner loop. No caution yet.
Lost the brakes going in and went vacuum cleaner.
Vacuum cleaner. And the caution flags out.
And again, they can
look at everybody coming onto pit road.
They were on pit road before the caution flag, before the pit road was closed.
If they can make it on fuel, what a brilliant move that was on all these crew chiefs' parts. Robbie Gordon's in. Ward Burton, Dale Jarrett. Dave?
The 29 car of Kevin Harvick is in. They're going to change four tires on his car. The rears were sliding. Robbie Gordon right behind him, his teammate. They're going to change four as well. Gordon off first. They may have just changed two guys. I couldn't see it.
Johnson, Steve Park.
You know, a lot of these guys have spotters back there in the inner loop where Rusty went off. And when they saw that, they were calling their coochies going, hey, there's going to be a yellow. And that was. That was an excellent move to call these guys in.
NASCAR checking the photo finish camera that they use on the caution flags to make sure that these cars were all past the caution flag on pit road before the yellow came out. And the word that came back is, yes, they were. Those stops are all legal. Beautiful call.
Absolutely. Great call.
And for those spotters back there to be being on their toes on that deal.
All right, what happened to Rusty Wallace?
Well, I was a little premature in saying they fixed their brake problem. You heard him say he gets down to turn 10 and just doesn't have any brakes.
And you see all the mud. We've just had an enormous amount of rain here at Watkins Glen over the weekend. In fact, they had a lot of trouble trying to get some of the fans into the parking lots today. They've had so much water on the property.
Go on board with Rusty Wallace and listen as he goes down to turn 10. See what it sounds like when you get in the corner with no brakes.
Now he wheel hopped.
Sounds like he's wheel hopping.
Absolutely, he wheel hopped, and that's exactly what we were talking about earlier. One of those corners where you get into the wheel hop. When you hear all that.
We're off in camp, Billy, but I don't think he hit it.
When you hear all that bouncing around. You could hear the rear of the car bounce, and that was the wheel hop.
And went vacuum cleaner.
And how frustrating.
Have to come in.
Boy, he's going
to
come in at the right time.
Got trouble. Kenny Wallace spun around.
across the racetrack.
One more. Inside, clear behind him. We got spun around, guys. Got hit from behind, spun around. Yeah, we're
see,
okay.
We see in the right rear where they made contact with Kenny Wallace.
That would have been a great break for Bobby if it would have went yellow.
Kenny was running 34th.
He now will go back to about 38th.
Yep. 38 cars on the lead lap here. Only car out of the race at Watkins Glen, Sterling Marlin, went out of the very first lap with an engine failure. Pace truck's out in front of the field here at Watkins Glen for the sixth time in the race.
The gravel trap got another one.
Todd Bodine.
That would be the hometown driver from nearby Chemung, New York, in the National Guard Ford, turn one.
Goes down the corner, and looks like he got that wheel hop going.
Yep, sure did.
And he almost saved it. Just gets the front in the gravel just enough that he's unable to. See how it sinks down?
Yeah.
And just sticks there.
Duck.
Those traps are there for safety. They slow a car down tremendously when it gets off the course and keeps them from impacting the barrier. The problem is if you get hung in one, you are hung in one.
Yeah.
Like he is hung in one, that one.
And taking about half the corner, a quarter of his car off there.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Wow.
Oh, my goodness.
That's what those tires do when they come apart.
And that's why NASCAR threw the caution flag to remove the debris from the racetrack, because it will puncture tires, and when you puncture tires, the result.
And that's not him hitting the wall. That's just from the tire.
Just for the tire coming apart.
Man, that's unbelievable damage. That's a backup car.
That's backup car.
Yep.
Mayfield was scheduled to start 40th, so it's not going to cost him much in terms of track position at the start of the race, but now they need to get that backup car out, get the safety inspection done, and try and get it on the track and get a few shakedown laps before this practice ends about a half an hour from now.
It's going to be a tough task for these guys.
Not even a half an hour from now. All right. While the red flag's out, let's go back into the garage. Marty?
Well, let's talk a little Ryan Newman, and these guys were so confident in the setup they had here in June. It did run well until the engine let go there in the fire that we saw just a moment ago. That in the first practice today, they experimented. That's the opposite of what most teams do. And then in this final practice, they went back to their setup they had here in June. They were very, very good in this practice. Just a little bit tight for Ryan. Bam, right back in the ballgame when they put that June setup in. Matt?
Well, Tony Stewart qualified 23rd, but he was one of those drivers that went out to qualify when the track temperature was at its hottest. 7th in practice, 10th in practice this morning, 9th in practice on Friday. But Tony's car has been very consistently tight. The car has not responded well to changes except for the changes they just made. A new left rear spring, new right front spring. Tony came on the radio and said, Zippy, I think we might have hit on it. Zippy told him just to stay out, get back in line, and make another run, and that's exactly what he's going to do.
Tony showing 7th fastest right now as Jeremy Mayfield limps his wounded Dodge back to the attention of his team, and no doubt straight to the hauler where they're already unloading the backup car. Red flag for a second time in happy hour here in Michigan. And the caution is out 15 laps into the race. That's tough.
Yeah, he was pretty excited yesterday. We talked to him about his race car. Really thought he had a very good car.
Well, this is the same car he used at Pocono and Indy that ran so well.
So, the field coming back to the caution flag.
All right, here we are on board. Looks like he may have had a tire go down to BP. Went up that racetrack pretty quick.
Yeah, went to the corner of the right front tire.
We're done now.
One of our stat guys just told me that he just lost.
Will it keep going or is it hurt?
The 10 spots in the last lap or so. So he realized the tire was going down, but.
Yeah, that's definitely a tire down.
He was trying to ride it out hoping for the caution, and he was the caution.
That usually happens. Boy, big break for Dale Earnhardt Jr. because
battling a tight race car from the get-go. Another track bar adjustment.
Todd Bodine and Kenny Wallace. Bodine's car is pitched up in the air.
Don't fire.
A heavy crash. Wow.
And Kenny Wallace both out of their cars.
Todd had the window net down before the car stopped.
And Kenny was getting out of his car before it stopped.
See Kenny's Hans device on the back of his neck.
Kenny's car was on fire. He was going to get out of that thing fast.
And there's Todd. See how Kenny's car was just submarined underneath Todd's? Todd's lucky he didn't go over on his roof. Third caution of the race.
I tell you what, I got to give these medical workers an A for their response because they were there.
They've always been great here at Michigan Speedway. They really have.
Helped by the fact that the field was still bunched up pretty tightly together on a restart. Once the pack went by the wreck, they could roll.
There you see the 54 car in the middle. Kenny Wallace up high.
This is racing for 25th place.
And Kurt Busch is going to get in the 54 and turn him up in front of the 23.
Yep.
Look at that.
Wow. And all that fire is coming from Kenny Wallace's car.
Yes. Well, the Todd Bodine was right down on the 97 car.
Heavy contact.
That's a big hit. Yeah.
Yeah, the left front wheel got ripped right off the car.
Watch the, if you keep watching this thing, watch the window net on Todd Bodine's car.
Watch Kenny. Kenny drops his right here.
Yeah, he drops his, and then Todd drops his, too, while he's still on top of Kenny.
To keep following this, I believe Kenny was out of his car before his car stopped.
And he was trying to get out. There.
Now that's a camera shot.
Ooh. Now that is an unmanned camera, so you know that's a camera that operates on a robot, so there wasn't anybody standing behind that. Tons of debris and a nasty accident, but both drivers out of their cars quickly and okay. And because the fires on those cars weren't in the trunk, that new fire extinguisher system that Dave showed you on Discover Card Countdown to Green doesn't come into play there. But look at the damage. None of the leaders have come down pit road. We'll take a break. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
See, when he felt that fire, he didn't know that it wasn't his car on fire.
Right.
It might have been his car, so he didn't realize it was Kenny Wallace's car that before he was feeling the heat.
He was feeling that heat, too.
Yeah, he was feeling that heat. He was like Kenny. He was getting out of there quick.
Look, they're bailing out of the cars, and there's still another car coming down the track.
Yeah. That's a scary thing, but when you're on fire, you're not thinking about that. You're just thinking about getting out.
That was an unbelievable hit. That was one of the hardest I've seen in a long time. And there goes the wheel, trying to catch up with his car. It's like a calf following his mama down the racetrack.
Despite the tethers that are supposed to hold him onto the track, the chassis.
I'm not sure that was a wheel or just the tire that ripped off a wheel.
Either way, both drivers out of their cars and okay. Pit road still closed. Waiting to see if they're going to open it this lap. But Todd Bodine and Kenny Wallace involved.
What, about 50, 60 miles? Oh, Ricky Craven in the wall.
Casey Mears.
Chest gets touched in the left rear and turned that 41 car head on in the wall.
Boy, he almost had it cleared.
That was more than a touch, wasn't it? Here comes Elliott Sauter to get a lap back. Does it?
He did it, yep.
Gentlemanly Kevin Harvick. So Ricky Craven getting up into the marbles and into the turn two wall, and then Casey Mears trying to take the high line around the crash, and there just wasn't a big enough gap.
You know, the lap before I saw Ricky in three and four, and he was right up against that wall. I don't know if that was a line he was running or if he was having a problem. But
Craven's always up there in a high line. Yeah. He's like Michael Waltrip, so it's a good bet it was. But look at where Casey.
Straight to the garage if you're still under power when you get back here, okay? I'm sure we got some good bet pretty good there.
I said something about a touch. We touched Casey Mears. That was more than a touch.
All right, let's take a look at what happened to Ricky Craven and Casey Mears.
You see Ricky up in the high line. Looks like he may have just got a little bit too high. Bounced off the wall, got in the marbles there is what it looked like.
Jumped the cushion, a dirt track phrase. just couldn't hold on to it.
Then he kind of coming off the wall. Then he turned back. Oh, man.
And launched that 41 car, didn't it?
Yeah.
Watch him launch that 41 right into the wall.
See that right front.
Bang. Oh,
right front,
man.
Wheel was is turned to the right, so it looked like he may have bent something in the steering. And that's why he was going back up the racetrack.
We got trouble at the entrance to pit road. Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt Jr. just tangled
coming onto the
pit stops. Look at the damage to Jr.'s car.
That's a lot of damage.
Tuck the left front fender in.
Man, watch this. They're trying to come to pit road. Ryan Newman fakes. Harvick's coming in. Rusty decides to go back out.
Ugh.
But Jr.'s there.
Hmm. That's unbelievable.
That is unbelievable.
What a mess. All right, Bill.
Well, you can imagine the conversation on the radio after that. Nobody very happy. Junior's on pit road. They go to the right side first. They're going to put the tires on. Then they'll have to come around to the left side. They're calling for hammers. They'll have to bang that sheet metal out around the left front, work on the lower front portion of the grill. They have to lift the car up to slide the jack underneath it because the tires are flat. They get it up, get the jack underneath. They got a lot of work ahead of them. They were running so well. In fact, Dale Earnhardt Jr. was joking with his crew that he was upset that they didn't let him pit last time. Now he's on pit road with big time problems here in Michigan. They want a bigger hammer, BP. That's never good.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I think they want to go down to the two pit with that hammer.
So after the charge through the field from 39th up into the top 10, Junior's got a messed up race car. Here's his onboard view of this.
Got to do one thing. Get out.
Oh, man. Man, I'd be hot.
No turn signals on these cars.
No, the blinker wasn't working.
Matt, why did Rusty all of a sudden decide to go back on the track?
Well, Benny, the original game plan, they were just going to do a gas and go, no tires. When crew chief Billy Wilburn saw that the 12, their teammate, Ryan Newman, was staying out, he called no pit, no pit, no pit, but it was too late. And that's when the contact was made.
There's a lot of ways to lose one of these races.
That's one of them.
That's one of them.
Hey, we told you at the beginning, watch out for trouble on pit road.
And that will affect the handling of Rusty's car quite a bit there as well. It doesn't. Eight cars got a lot of damage on the left front, which probably would be worse in his case. Matt, what's going on down there in two car?
Well, they're looking at the fender damage to the two car, Rusty Wallace. You can see Robbie Fuller and the guys working on that right rear. They're loosening the lugs on the left side to try to cut down on the time. So when Robbie comes back around, you can see them, though, beating on the damage to that right rear quarter panel on the Blue Deuce. Tough break for Rusty Wallace.
Matt, I just hope they remember they have the lug nuts off the left side. If the pace car starts coming, they might let the car down and shoot back on the racetrack. Remember, guys, the lug nuts are off the left side.
Put the tire on to get the left side changed so we don't get caught in the pit. Just make sure there's nothing from it.
You heard Billy Wilburn remind his team the left side lugs are loose. They're going to change those tires if they have time. They are going to try to get those left sides done on this stop.
Yeah, they got plenty of time.
All right, so a couple of guys running in the top 10 get tangled up. One trying to get to pit road, one trying not to. Meantime, Ryan Newman did not. I guess one of the things.
Oh, trouble stretch.
Steve Park, Kyle Petty, Todd Bodine got a piece of it, and I believe Christian Fittipaldi did also.
Man, oh man.
Well, that took six laps. And that'd be the second car of the weekend for Steve Park, who had a practice crash here on Friday, yesterday.
Yeah, let's see who should be mad here.
Well, we see Todd Bodine, the 54 car, and looks like Jeff Green gets in the back of the 30. Jeff Green, the one, gets in the back of Steve Park, and up the hill he goes. Into the wall, and Kyle Petty.
I think Todd is going to get into Kyle here, trying to avoid Steve Park.
Yep.
Locked him up, got bumped by Casey Mears, clunk. So that didn't take long. The first angry drivers of the night have been found here in Bristol.
The toughest ticket in NASCAR. Bristol Motor Speedway for the night race. Under caution early after a multi-car crash. Here's our Wendy's race menu. The Southern 500 next Sunday. NBC 12:30 Eastern Time from Darlington Raceway. That'll be a good one. Remember the finish there in the spring between Kurt Busch and Ricky Craven? See some more of that excitement next weekend. Then it's on to Richmond, New Hampshire, and Dover as we cover the race for the championship on NBC and TNT. Marty.
Well, Todd, this is a little early even for Bristol. What happened?
Typical Bristol. A couple guys in front of us got squirrely, and we all started checking up. And you got the rule of five here at Bristol. Yeah, I don't know, can't see who it is, but you got the rule of five. The fifth car back usually gets turned around. Unfortunately, there was probably four of us in this one, but there's nothing I could do. I got run into from behind. I saw it happening. It looks like Casey got me from behind there, but I just one of those deals at Bristol, nothing you can do about it. It's a shame for National Guard and his crew. We had a really good car. We were 13th in happy hour, really good on old tires. Everything you need at Bristol to run up front. Unfortunately, now we're behind the wall, National Guard Ford.
Spectacular wreck last week, early wreck this week. Dave?
30 car of Steve Park thought they could go ahead and fix the toe, get it back out there. He realized they couldn't. They're going to have to replace, among other things, a left side tie rod and a center link. Those are suspension parts. Steve's going to be in here a while. Alan?
All right, Dave, thanks. One to go here is the signal. They'll go back under. You just saw the leader, Jeff Gordon, take the caution flag. Second time tonight here in the Sharpie 500. A little chain reaction incident over in turn two involving Jason Leffler and Greg Biffle, among others. Also Scott Wimmer involved. And you see Leffler looking like going to need a new radiator on the Net Zero car.
Yeah, that's not pretty. Here we go.
I think everybody just checked up because Burton got a little bit loose there. And then it's the typical old accordion effect here at BP. Everybody checked up, and we didn't see the contact on that shot there between Jason Leffler and Greg Biffle, but it was a pretty good hit.
How about Leffler into Wimmer?
Yeah, that's right. Wimmer got Biffle.
Yeah, look at all the cars.
Down, hits the wall hard from the inside.
Watch all the cars just in front of Jeff Gordon when they came ripping through there. They were about to get lapped. What a huge break for Sterling Marlin and some others.
Oh, I see why Jeff Burton got loose.
Yeah, now I do too.
Biffle got in the back of him, and when he backed off,
yeah,
Wimmer didn't.
And Jeff Gordon let Joe Nemechek, his teammate, get that lap back.
And here come all the leaders on to pit road, Dave.
Ryan, and mega pressure on Ryan Newman by Jeff Gordon.
Oh, Newman can't hang on to it. And here comes the field.
Man, oh, man.
He's mad.
Don't hit him. Don't hit him. There you go.
How many we have to? We have McGilvin back.
All right, wait a minute now. We had four in the first one.
Right.
Three in the second one. No, wait. 99, 16. Four in the second one.
So this is.
This is nine now.
It'd be nine mad guys.
Do you agree with my math there?
Oh, man. I will on this one, yeah.
Thank you. Ryan Newman racing for second a minute ago. Now he's trying to gather it back up and get back going in the right direction. He and Jeff Gordon making contact, bringing out the third caution here at Bristol. As Rusty Wallace had no place to go, with Waltrip coming down the track right into his path. Greg Biffle, Tony Raines getting laps back from Jeff Gordon. Michael Waltrip, fifth in the championship standings, racing for the ninth position.
Now there's one angry guy right
there.
We got
more mad people.
Yeah, he is really mad.
Who's he mad at?
We're going to find out just in 1 second. As soon as he can get out and show his displeasure.
At whoever he's mad at.
That's right. He's going to show us. No, he's not. Man, is he mad. Because he had a great race car. They came up here. They tested. They really felt like tonight could be their night. Rusty's out of his car. It's a good sign.
Yeah. Yeah, Wally, you talked about in Wally's World as being a self-cleaning racetrack, and things that happen on the track were going to end up at the bottom.
Yep, you want to, a lot of times, 9 out of 10 times, you want to go above the crash if you're seeing it from here, because the cars always slide back down the racetrack.
Oh, my goodness gracious. And I see why Michael was so upset. He was upset at himself.
Yeah.
Because he caught too much of the apron, and I think, and lost the car.
And we'll watch him here as he goes down into turn three. He drops down, hits that apron, gets the car loose, and bam, and then the big bam. Oh, that was our camera.
And the lights went out.
So caution is out for the fourth time in the Sharpie 500. Michael Waltrip, fifth in the championship. He's got big problems tonight. Michael Waltrip was racing for eighth position with Jeff Green. In turn three and four.
Into that 15.
Michael Waltrip has finished every race so far this season.
His wife Buffy's watching. I don't think he's going to finish tonight, Alan.
No. Marty?
And he's very disgusted. Michael, what happened?
Just ran out of room. Jeff squeezed me down a little bit, and I hit the apron and got loose. So just unfortunate. We got two tires, and the car was a little tight for a few laps. But it was coming around. I got under Jeff, and, you know, I just got squeezed in a little bit tight and just messed up. Jeff's doing his job, and just hate it for Rusty and hate it for our whole Napa team. Everybody's doing such a great job this year. It's a shame to have a setback like this, but we can go win Darlington, and this won't seem near as important.
This team has made very few mistakes this year. They haven't had a DNF since last year at Richmond.
Going to be a little bit more time cleaning this thing up. Pit road has been closed so far, so let's take a break. Under caution for the fourth time in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol.
Oh, three wide.
Oh,
Larry Foyt bumped by Jeff Green. Here we go.
Of course, a three wide just doesn't work.
You know, we got another car spinning in the back.
Joe Nemechek.
And he gets hit by...
That was Bill Elliott.
And Elliott got hit by someone.
Now watch Robbie Gordon.
Robbie Gordon trying to get it back, but I don't think Jeff Gordon is going to give it to him back. Do you think?
So there we go. Spotters telling the drivers the cars are all off the track in the accident site, and they race back around to the caution.
I think Robbie was going to get, or Jeff was going to get Robbie that night.
There's that whole gentleman's agreement.
Yeah, yeah, well, these two had a discussion about that.
Yes, they did.
A little while ago.
Well, that one didn't take long to come out. Three wide does not generally work well here at Bristol, nor does it work well when one car gets run into the backup by another. Larry Foyt in the spin cycle along with Joe Nemechek. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Okay, quick guess at home. Will the camera live through the accident?
On board with Dale Jarrett.
Check up. Check up. Check up. All right, come on down. Come on down. Come on down.
Uh-oh. Made it.
Jamie McMurray with the camera on the nose of the Texaco Haviland car.
What a great camera shot.
Oh, and Dave Blaney just sweet.
Uh-oh.
Turn three.
Big trouble.
Tony Stewart, Joe Nemechek, Casey Mears. Now Bobby Labonte behind them. What a miserable corner for Joe Gibbs. You see Stewart limping away.
Oh,
and the leader just got slammed.
Just about got drove over by Sauter.
Johnny Benson trying to get a lap back. And Jeremy Mayfield.
Man.
Okay. That was interesting.
That was real interesting. I haven't seen it yet, but I bet you lap car has.
I think right here, believe it or not, I think the trouble started with Matt Kenseth. He may have, I think the right rear tire is flat on Kenseth's car. He slowed off turn two and jammed all the cars up behind him. What a break for Kenseth.
Yeah.
Marty.
Boy, BP, if you ever wonder if the championship is destined for Matt Kenseth, he just called the team, said, I have a flat right rear, I'm coming to you on pit road, and that's what jacked up all the traffic, brought out the caution. Now he gets to pit under the caution and won't go a lap down.
All right, let's go back and reconstruct what happened. Watch Matt Kenseth.
Here he comes off the corner, and these cars behind him much faster than Kenseth. And here, Kurt Busch gets in the back of the 41 car, and Tony Stewart gets... Who's the
everybody
got hooked with Joe Nemechek.
Joe Nemechek.
Well, that don't happen way back there with Bobby.
Now, watch in the top right. There's Christian Fittipaldi smoking.
Never see Bobby Labonte trying to avoid hitting other cars. Backing in the fence.
And watch Johnny Sauter and Jeff Gordon.
Just hit him barely, but
on board with Kurt Busch.
Doesn't take much.
Hold on, someone going outside.
Jimmy Johnson.
It's apron, buddy. Come on. Come on. Clear high. Caution's out, buddy. Great job, Jimmy.
Sixth caution of the night is out at Bristol. Ryan Newman goes around, Ted Musgrave, Jeff Burton in it, Dave Blaney's in it. Caution's out. Looks like Burton got the worst of it.
And Tony Raines is going to get his lap back.
One of them.
Yeah, one of them.
Oh, man.
Right, let's see what happened on this one. We got how many more bad guys here? Three, four. See Ted Musgrave in the seven car. Looks like he got the back of Ryan Newman. Got him turned around, and then he got turned around by Jeff Burton.
And then he's going to get turned around by
Dave Blaney. There's four mad guys to go to the list.
Yeah. And, you know, the 12 car, Newman, continues on. I don't think he's got a lot of damage, but these cars do.
Yeah. Saturday night at Bristol, a lot of racing, a lot of wrecking. And there'll be some tempers flaring up tonight. From Mike Skinner, the caution is out. Jeff Green has crashed.
Well, that one car's had a long night already. It's only 192 laps in.
I don't know if he's finished it off here.
He definitely has finished it off.
It might be merciful.
Merciful.
Eighth caution flag tonight.
It looks like someone so many times we see a little bit of bump going in the corner and they back them in the wall. That's what they look like. Let's see what happens.
Yeah, you're on the edge at this place all the time anyway, so it doesn't take a whole lot of contact. That's exactly what happened, BP. Just a little touch like that.
That was for 19th place.
And it looks like, racing. Oh, you're okay, until you come up to that part right there.
A lot of sparks there. Thank goodness the fuel didn't rupture.
Bristol in a minute. Half a lap away from the restart in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol Motor Speedway. Caution out for the eighth time because Jeff Green got turned around into the outside wall in turn three. But kind of a rough night for Jeff. This was seven laps into the race.
Yeah, Jeff tagged that guy. Well, he didn't really have a whole lot to do, maybe a little bit to do with that. Then he tagged that guy. And well, he made a lot of people mad.
And this time he gets tagged.
He kept saying, thank you, guys, thank you, thank you. This car is just so awesome.
Troubles for Ted Musgrave. No caution yet. Now the caution comes out. Musgrave trying to limp around after getting squeezed into the backstretch wall. As he and Ricky Craven got tangled together there, I think.
And once again, I think this was a break for Matt Kenseth. Looked to me like he had started struggling, had gone back to the 13th position. There he is.
I mean, I'm just wondering if we need to set of tires, but I don't know. I guess take a half a pound out of the right rear and let's put a turn of wedge in the left rear.
And that's one thing the drivers are always worried about, too, especially Ricky Rudd.
Four tires, guys.
He wants to make sure that they put the exact same tires or type of tires on the car, pressures and everything. The car was so good, you don't want to make a pit stop and have that car change.
They didn't come down pit road because the pace car hasn't gathered up the field quite yet. They kind of missed connections there, Jeff Gordon and the pace car. Check it out, coming off in turn two.
We haven't seen. Looked like Ricky just turned into him.
Clear high. Sorry.
Tell you one thing, there's a lot of damage to that 32 car, I believe.
Yeah, there's a lot of damage on the right side.
Trouble turn three. Scott Wimmer sliding down to the bottom of the corner.
No caution.
Not yet.
He's off the racetrack. Should not be a caution.
Got it fired.
Got it fired. We're staying under green. Look at Robbie Gordon coming up alongside Joe Nemechek. Robbie back on track after losing
six laps
for repairs. And he may have some more repairs to make right now.
Here's one thing. When you're 68 laps down and you start racing with guys, guys aren't going to put up with that. If a guy's starting to race for me when somebody's 68 laps down, you're just not going to have any patience with them at all.
Nemechek back on the lead lap coming to the caution, and Sterling Marlin's teammate Casey Mears getting one of two laps. He's down, back coming to the yellow. And Robbie's going back behind the wall. Tough night. 10th caution here in the Sharpie 500.
Still there. Another one there. Inside. 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 Wall.
Telling you what, 10 cautions and we're just halfway in the race. We might be rocking and rolling here all night. Christian Fittipaldi, front straightaway. Caution flag number 11.
Uh-oh. That's my number, wasn't it? I ain't have any more.
Yeah. And just to finish the story briefly, Jimmy Spencer could not be hurt any worse by missing this race.
Yeah, he loves this place.
This is his best racetrack. And caught into the inside wall. It's Larry Foy. And yes, the caution flag is out.
EP, you're out of here.
Just blew right by my number.
Uh-huh.
Is Casey Mears going to get a lap back? Is Mark going to let him do it? Yes, he did.
That will put Casey Mears on the lead lap.
That was a gentleman thing to do.
Let's see if someone was not very gentlemanly to Larry Foy.
My guess, that would be in the affirmative.
Oh, no, that just got out from under him there. Then he got finished off. Another caution at Bristol. We'll be back. Oh, it's Elliott Sadler. Up the bank, down the bank. And big damage.
And the radiator is broken as you see that trail of water, and another caution flag.
That is a similar looking incident to the one he had last year, after which he got out and slapped the side of the ambulance.
Well, let's see if some of these made him mad.
Me and Johnny Sauter.
And he tried to turn away from spinning out Johnny Sauter, and guess what?
But he's mad at himself.
Mad at himself, yeah.
Up the track, back around, down, look at him, he's still chasing it. Joe Nemechek squeaks by and catches a piece of it.
And that's who got him last year, wasn't it? Nemechek? Wasn't that what that was all about? Between him and Elliott? Who's he mad at last year?
I'm trying to remember now. You put me on the spot, and I'm drawing a blank. Was it Joe?
Nemechek, yeah.
This is going to leave a mark. Ooh. Caution number 14. Here at Bristol. The wall, turn four. Bobby Labonte. Caution flag is out. And this would be number 15.
Okay, those guys have talked about 350, 350. Now might be the time for them to make a pit stop.
162, it'll be 161 to go, and Ryan Newman gets picked up by the pace car. What a lousy night for Bobby Labonte.
He can't take too many hits with the back of that car.
No.
Be the second one.
He's tearing up the pieces pretty soon.
All right, so 161 to go.
And Bobby Labonte is going to take his car behind the wall directly. Will not stop and go. Will not collect any money.
Had enough.
Okay, here they come to the opening of the backstretch pit road. Who comes in? First, second, third, fourth, ninth, and a spinner down the front stretch and one into the outside wall. It's Mark Martin. Before we even get to tell you what happened to Mark Martin on his pit stop, he's into the outside wall.
And Mark was in such a good spot when after you tell what happened. Yeah, after the pit stop. And he had to come in, Alan, I'll tell you about that. But what a...
Put it away and let's load this car up.
Mark came in, got fuel only on his pit stop, got off pit road ahead of all the other guys that pitted, but the catch can went with him out of his pit box.
Yeah.
He had to come back in. It put him back 26th in line, and that's what happens at Bristol when you get back in line.
Exactly. I mean, you talk about track position. Well, track position will hurt you here at Bristol. Watch here. See, right behind the eight car, the six car leaves, and there's the catch can. Comes flying out of the box. You cannot take equipment out of the box. So he had to come in for a stop and go. Problem is, he got back in the back of the pack, and we always say those yellows breed yellow, especially this time at Bristol.
All right, here's what happened to bring out the caution flag. Top of the screen. Looked like Johnny Sauter and maybe Bill Elliott got tangled up.
Boy, Mark just got collected.
Sauter came off the wall and just caught Mark in the right rear as he went by, turning head on in the wall. Dave?
Now let's catch up with Mark here. Mark checking out the damage and collecting his things. Mark, tell us about that.
Johnny Sauter, he lost it. He's a weapon out there all night, man. I couldn't believe it. You know, and I see he's still out there running. I don't know. This wasn't our night. We had a great car. It's just, that just figures, you know. I really believe that we had a chance to win that thing.
It looked like it from down here and up there too, guys, didn't it?
Oh, I mean, he had a great car and he was in a great spot. But unfortunately, that mishap in the pits put him in a bad position on the restart of this race. When you're back there with those guys, sometimes you get caught up.
So Mark Martin, you could put him on the angry list.
Yeah, he was smiling, but he wasn't happy.
Yeah. Bill?
Just want to follow up on the Mark Martin catch can, Alan. When he left and that catch can fell, the gasoline that spilled behind the 8 car, the rear tire changer and the tire carrier slipped in that. That slowed Junior's stop and put him further back in the field.
Yeah, Junior's back in 19th.
A lot of people are about to go. Oh, turn one. Sterling Marlin has crashed. Second place car.
And the caution flag is out.
Man, this is unbelievable.
I don't think the TV show Survivor's got anything on these guys.
No.
This could be the last one running tonight. Sterling Marlin was running second when he went off into turn one. Uh-oh.
He's going to get some help from Kurt Busch.
Sure did. And I'll tell you what, when you get hit going into a corner, there's not a whole lot you can do.
That's the worst.
Watch here as he goes down at turn one. Gets in the back of Sterling. When you're turning down into the racetrack goes, and you're already loose, getting
in, all around.
I'll tell you what, there's not a whole lot you can do to save it. Dave?
They don't think it's been up too bad. Changed right side tires only. Didn't pull any damage out at this point. They may come back around and do that. Guys, they were only about 10 laps shy and needed 10 yellow laps to make this thing go to the end, and they didn't want to be part of that.
And the reason they would just change the two and come back around, because they're toward the end of the field, you don't have a whole lot of time for when you get to your pit stall before you might get lapped by the pace car here at Bristol.
Not too sure he doesn't have some damage to those trailing arms, that rear suspension on that Coors Light car. We'll see. Once the car gets... The left rear tire might have caught some of that abuse with the wall. And...
There's the stack up we're talking about. Kenny Wallace got in the side of Casey. They did a good job.
Now they come down into the corner. Clunk, funk, bang. Sterling Marlin's car sits broadside across the racetrack.
21's got some damage there.
21, look at the right front on the 21 car. Oh, man.
Bill? Dale Jr. was just in.
He got right side tires there, and they had to pull the sheet metal away from the right front. His car is free in, free off, tight in the center. But they were very concerned about some right front damage, and that's what they worked on.
Ricky Rudd also in. Sterling Marlin making that second pit stop under this caution flag. The second place driver spun out, and we're under caution again at Bristol. 17 done here at Bristol back in March. Jeff Gordon with his fresh tires.
Oh!
Matt Kenseth in the traffic jam gets Gordon.
Well, there's a caution flag that Jared needed, but it certainly wasn't one.
He lifted right in front of me.
That was Matt Kenseth on his team radio. Jeff Gordon with a beat-up front end on his Chevy now.
There's another one, Matt.
Yep.
Looked like Gordon had to lift because Schrader got loose, or what Bill say, he was bad tight off the corner, so maybe Schrader had to check up and it caused the accordion.
Now let's take a look here.
Schrader's real slow right there. Gordon tries to duck down underneath him. Got tagged by the 17 car. Couldn't really.
Third one in line.
Yeah,
but you're right. The 49 car, I guess, picked up that dreadful push off the corner. Had to back up. And when Jeff backed up, back off the gas to turn under the 49, that's when Kenseth got in the back of him.
He had a tire going down, Benny. Left front tire going down on the 49.
Okay.
Really? Matt Kenseth. Well, what has been a very difficult last month or so for Jeff Gordon continues tonight here at Bristol. He's finished in the 30s, three of the last four races.
And the local car, driven by Johnny Sauter, going behind the wall. Marty!
Going to hold on the ninth where we were, and there's a spin on the track.
Tony Raines gets turned around in turn two, and the caution flag is out. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, for a record-tying 20th time. That equals the track record for the most yellows all time in a Winston Cup race here at Bristol. And Tony Raines, who got back on the lead lap after falling behind early in the race with a slow-leaking tire, I believe got back around on the lead lap.
Yeah, he did.
Did the leader get us? He did get us. You're all right.
You're okay. That's right. But he's mad.
I can't think this tight to center, Larry. I just can't get going, man. I just keep running over me in the middle.
Come on down pit road. It's a quick yellow. You're going to have to start at the tail end of the longest line.
You know, we keep trying to come back from these commercial breaks in time so we get the restarts. So it left us with a little unfinished business last time.
The Sharpie 500 from Bristol Motor Speedway. Brought to you by Sharpie. Right out loud. Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. And the United States Army.
Some of the 44 drivers have been out, and here's Mongo. Mr. Excitement, Jimmy Spencer, who provoked quite a reaction from the crowd last week at Bristol, Tennessee. Free Jimmy.
Lost puppy.
Lost puppy. And there are a few funny ones we can't show you.
And I'm going to tell you what, you ought to see the fans' reaction right now. I don't think any of the people
standing up.
Are sitting down.
Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Bad dog, no biscuit.
Just got away from him off turn four.
That was Tommy Baldwin, you hear. The right front is locked up. And Spencer will take a provisional. Darn it.
I hate that for Jimmy because he was so pumped up about coming to this racetrack and getting qualified for this race. Now, things are going to be a little bit tough for him, but knowing his attitude right now, he'll be positive about it. He'll come back and he and Tommy Baldwin will unload a backup car and he'll get the job done come Sunday.
This is the same car that he actually ran at Michigan a couple of weeks ago and knocked the nose off in the garage area. Nose off the car.
Yeah. Glad you clarified that.
Coming to take the green. There you see it. Got loose with him. He corrected it, overcorrected, and it just came back around again with him. And that's a pretty hard lick. That, like you say, Mike, provisional land and probably backup car. Yep.
Kind of killed the right front of that one. Doesn't take much.
Well, these drivers know with just doing one lap of qualifying, I think we were talking about this earlier, that speed can so much be dictated by how you get through three and four come to take the green. You need to really build that speed coming off turn four, and it just got away from Jimmy.
He was trying so hard to carry that speed momentum through that corner.
Jeff, did you hear it sound like something drug on the racetrack? Is that a word? Dragged on the racetrack just prior to that car getting out of shape, like something bottomed out there to cause him to lose control.
It very easily could have, Mike. I didn't quite hear it, but at the same time, right where he was picking the throttle up is where that would normally happen.
Well, you're running the left front so soft here, Mike, sometimes if you snatch it back right, it'll bottom the left front out. But it'd be interesting to interview Jimmy to see if it just came around with him or if he does think maybe something broke on it or whatever.
Let's look and listen.
I think the sound that you heard was after the car got loose and he tried to correct. Like Larry said, you hear it bottom out again. And it came around.
Marty?
A lot of noise there on that wreck, Jimmy. What happened?
Just lost it, you know. Drove down in the corner, got a little loose, and put the power back to it. When it caught, it was headed the wrong way. So trying to sit on the pole, and that's what happened. Just sit on the wall instead.
Pretty good crunch, obviously, backup car.
Oh, yeah, there's no question. That hit hard at Darlington, yep.
All right, Jimmy Spencer will be in the backup car. A lot of damage to the 7 car, Matt.
Yeah, Michael Waltrip's car just now finally.
Today in our coverage of the NASCAR Busch Series 200. Oh, trouble, turn 3. 4 cars, 5 cars involved.
And Dale Jarrett.
Michael Waltrip, Dale Jarrett just got a piece of Waltrip. Got Christian Fittipaldi and Rusty Wallace all in the wreck. That's 2 weeks in a row. Look at that.
My goodness.
I think a lot of that was from the 88 hit him.
Yeah.
The second impact there.
So that engine change, Dale Jarrett qualified 19th. Rusty Wallace still sitting on the racetrack. Dale Jarrett qualified 19th, but during his qualifying run, tagged a valve.
Can't get it to go.
With a piston, had to change it.
Christian Fittipaldi. And add Tony Raines to that list of drivers I gave you.
That's a lot of damage to that car,
yeah.
Wally.
Yeah.
Man.
Every end, size, both sides.
There's Tony Raines. And his first Southern 500 start. Now check that, his second Southern 500 start will come up very short.
Well, the 43 car is the first one we see in the wall. What caused that, all that to begin? No way of knowing.
Like zero got into the left rear quarter panel, the 43 car of Christian Fittipaldi. Looks like what started it.
This won't be a good view. This is onboard Michael Waltrip.
What's up, guys?
Not a whole lot he can do on that.
We're trying to make it here on pit road. Enjoy.
And an equally ugly view onboard Dale Jarrett's car.
In here, stay down, all the way down. Damn.
Didn't get down far enough.
Could not get down far enough because he was just going too fast to go all the way down on the apron and not spin. Matt?
Benny, Dale Jarrett just left his pit stall. He came on the radio and said, we have killed the right front. He said, it is towed out big time. I can barely turn it. He's going to come back in. They tried to pull away some of that sheet metal. He's going to come back in again, so they try to fix that toe. Heartbreak for this guy. His dad won this race back in 65 by 14 laps. He wants to win one of the last Labor Day Southern 500s.
Remember last Saturday night at Bristol, Michael Waltrip and Rusty Wallace in an early accident that knocked them both out of the race. Both drivers' cars heavily damaged here early in the Southern 500. This was last Saturday night at Bristol.
And watch this. Rusty Wallace comes along right there and pounds the back of that 15 car. As a matter of fact, Rusty went to the hospital for checkup. Everything was okay, but really rung his bell.
That was last weekend. Now this weekend, just a handful of laps into this race, 6 laps as a matter of fact, both drivers' cars heavily damaged in another scramble, this one up in turns 3 and 4. So got a half a dozen cars involved in the wreck, and pit road is still closed because there's a lot of safety equipment sitting at the entry to the pit lane. So none of the lead cars should be coming in. There you see those involved in this early accident at Darlington. Ryan Newman is the leader. We're under caution in the Mountain Dew Southern 500.
Southern
back. So well, I said, ain't no competition out here. I think I'm going to sit in the grand. In the
hey,
pool.
You still got your suit on, so you're hoping one of those guys needs some relief. I know what you're thinking.
Jeff Gordon just got a little back bumper damage on this restart as we go back. And stay with us here. Kale, call a few laps if you wouldn't mind.
All right.
Appreciate you being here. Gordon got his back bumper beat in on the restart. We'll follow up on that here in a second. Look at Mark Martin's nose.
Wow, I guess he got a beat in.
He was the one. And Jeff, Joe Nemechek, rather, caught a piece of somebody in his left rear.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. I'm like Benny and Wally. You know, if something's going to happen to your race car, you want it to happen early here and happen good.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is a killer to run all day long and then or either have to fight a bad race car all day.
I'll tell you, I don't know how Mark can even see.
I don't either.
Kevin Harvick.
I don't think he can see.
Trying to work on Mark Martin. That is going to be for 14th spot.
Yeah, this isn't a place that you want to have a wounded race car for 500 miles.
And Sterling Marlin all of a sudden just pulls over in a Coors Light car. Something up with that car. You know, they talked about a miss yesterday morning.
Leroy, see the busted radiator. This knocked the duck work out. He crumpled the front end in pretty good.
He got a piece of Joe Nemechek.
I think he may have a, it looked like the right rear tire was low from that back angle, but.
There's what Mark is trying to look over, and let's see if we can see exactly what might have happened on the restart that caused all these problems.
Let's see, going up through the gears. Well, it looked like a bunch of guys just checked up in front of Jeff.
Yeah. So there's the back bumper damage on the 24.
A lot better back there than the front of these cars.
Yeah, he got the better end of that.
There's where Kansas got hit by Jeff.
Matt, any damage on this 17 car?
BP jumped on the radio and asked his team to look at that grill just to see if there's any damages as the water is starting to climb up over 230 right now. Robbie Ryder said that looks okay. We'll have to start pulling tape on that first stop.
That certainly looks okay.
All right, while all that's been going on, Rusty Wallace has come out of the infield medical center. Let's hear from him. Marty?
Rusty, what happened?
About four or five cars spun right in front of me. We went into turn three, everything was fine, car was running great, a little tight, that was about it. Went in and all of a sudden I saw three cars spin and I was up top of the racetrack already and they just all crashed up into me and that was it.
2 weeks in a row for these guys, but tonight they will be able to fix the car and get out there and limp around for a little while.
I'll be surprised to see if he doesn't have water temperature problems in that six car here pretty soon.
He's got handling problems, obviously. He's falling back through the field a good bit. They could use a caution flag, they just don't want to be it.
Yeah.
Allen?
Trouble turn four. Looks like Mike Skinner has had problems. And the caution flag is out. The Army car with right front damage.
Yep, on the whole right side damaged.
Skinner running 26th and last on the lead lap at the time of his problem.
Boy, this racetrack is so hard.
I said it will reach out and bite you.
We talked about it yesterday in the NASCAR Busch Series race. It's almost like there's a magnet. If you get too close, the magnet just grabs the car and sucks you right into it.
And you can never get comfortable here. I mean, it just if you just slip up, especially on worn tires, if you just slip up a little bit, you run so close to the wall anyway, if you're off just a little bit, you're in it hard.
26 laps since the last pit stops. Everybody will be in.
Oh, yes.
See if we can see what might have happened to Skinner.
Very top of the screen.
Like he just got in the corner. Something might have broken, but it certainly got in too hard into the wall. And NASCAR has to throw the caution flag to check for all the debris.
Skinner takes his car to the garage as the. And now Kurt Busch. Oh, trouble. Jeff Gordon, Johnny Benson, Ken Schrader, and Casey Mears. Dave Blaney's in it also. That's turn three and four.
Jeff Gordon's bad luck continues. Kenny Schrader had a good run going in the lead lap.
Oh, Jimmy Johnson, the leader. Bouncing off Michael Waltrip's car as he slows for the caution.
What was
that? Did he get the grill on it?
He might have.
Let me see here.
No, it looks pretty good. He's okay.
Boy.
Hey, man. There, buddy. I believe it's okay.
Just tagged the back of the 15. He was sitting there parked to the debris, and there was nowhere else to go except through it, and I slid in the back of him and hit him.
Fine. I mean, the grill isn't even punched in. You're fine.
not fine is his teammate, Jeff Gordon, who got the back end torn up on a restart. Now he's got the nose torn off it. What a month of misery it's been for Jeff Gordon.
And Johnny Benson, serious damage to the Valvoline Pontiac. What serious damage.
These guys are tearing up every corner of these race cars today.
Yeah, that's a pretty good looking grill. It doesn't look like he punched
it. Can see the marks right there above the right light. The decal of the light.
Gordon around. Don't know why. Wow, look at Benson get punched up in the air by Schrader.
And Kenny Wallace.
Kenny almost missed it.
Almost missed it, but not quite.
See if we can see what started this, BP.
See the 41 car and Jeff Gordon are going to make contact right here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, 41 thought he was clear, and he wasn't. Boy, Bobby Labonte slipped through there. And Schrader barreled in there.
And Jeff Gordon gets pounded right in the driver's door, but he drove the car in, so obviously he's okay.
It's our camera.
Broke the glass on our camera.
Yeah, it looked like the 41 of Casey Mears just thought he was clear, and he pulled up in front of Jeff Gordon. Jeff was there, and a lot of guys paid for that mistake.
Jeff Gordon to the garage, Johnny Benson to the garage. And they're still cleaning up down inside turns 3 and 4. Ken Schrader's team getting a new nose piece ready for that car. Another 6-car wreck.
Well, this is Southern 500. Don't expect much else, do we?
Hot and slippery.
Hot and slippery and a lot of crashes.
Talked about Jeff Gordon's month of misery. Had a crash, the crash at Pocono, finished 36th. Got spun out twice at Watkins Glen, including off the last corner, finished 33rd. Finished 30th at Michigan, had a lap 50 flat. Had the wreck at Bristol last week with about 50 laps to go, finished 28th. And now he's in the garage all torn up here today. Not too good.
Not when you're sitting on the champion.
Oh, I didn't. I just. Oh, trouble, Joni Maciek. Caution's out. Flat left side tires.
Big break for Kurt Busch. He gets. Stay back in the lead lap.
Gets the mile and a third pass. Here's Sterling Marlin to try and get one of his laps back. Ken Schrader just in front of him back on track after 55 laps in the garage for repairs. Sixth caution.
Both left side tires are flat.
Got loose and then got hit.
Yes, that's correct.
And then got behind on his steering.
Once these left tires blow out, as he locks up the brakes and just grinds that rubber. Just grinds the rubber. Come on, cue the tires. There's one. Boom. There we go.
Roof flap up there. The car gets turned around backwards.
Still sliding.
He wrecked for the whole back straightaway.
There's a contact between he and Spencer.
That's what you call a tank slapper.
Yes.
You're fighting that thing right and left, and the fuel in the tank is slapping back and forth and not helping you any.
And luckily did not hit that inside wall.
Pit stops for all the leaders. Marty.
Kevin Harvick in third, and believe it or not, those laps that he led earlier were the first Winston Cup lap.
Ken Schrader. Back on track after the wreck earlier. Something else has gone wrong for the 49. In a big way.
Yeah. I wonder if that. I wonder if that hood blew up.
Right front's flat on it.
Yeah.
He's obviously hit the wall. Greg Biffle letting some people get a lap back there to the caution flag. Mark Martin, Todd Bodine. And Dale Jr. gets one of his laps back. That'll put him now 9 laps down. He'll be racing with Ryan Newman.
Yeah.
Tough day for Schrader. Was one of the drivers involved in the big 6-car wreck back at lap 167.
Hmm.
That even tore the cowl flaps and everything else off just below the windshield. Well, it'll be a day he'll be glad to see be over. So that was the kill switch on Ryan Newman's car. Unbelievable.
Okay, now he can put on tires? You bet.
Oh, yeah. 500. And Greg Biffle will slow. Doesn't look like anybody is going to get many laps back. Looks like Kenny Wallace has dropped something. He's bounced off the wall in the Stacker 2 car.
Kenny was involved in that wreck earlier.
Yep.
In turns 3 and 4, see all the damage that was from that wreck.
But you know what? We have to apologize to Dave, because now four car Kevin LePage had fallen back to 14th, but he can stop now, change four tires, and be just like everybody else.
He didn't lose anything.
No, he
didn't. Four car. He gained a couple laps up front, but he didn't lose anything either.
Sorry, Dave.
So we'll get ready
What's
for
that
some
guy? Sorry.
Stops.
Sorry, Dave. Hope you'll expect.
What happened now?
The four car. He's okay.
Oh well, no, that's all right. You know, I don't exonerate me yet. He may go down a lap later for a mistake on pit road. You got to make these calls under pressure, don't you?
Yes, you do.
Everything worked out for them, though. Good to see Kevin LePage back in a Winston Cup car. See a little bit of damage there, right front, left rear. It's not been a completely clean day for LePage, but again, he's on the lead lap. And there are only 18 of the 43 starters that are still on the lead lap.
Yeah, they're having a good race.
Yep.
He rises, I believe, to the top.
So you mean about 10, 15 laps to go. Oh, we see the 31 car has made contact with the wall. And he has again. This is probably going to bring out the caution.
If he's got a right front flat there, I don't know if that happened afterwards.
Why the hell ain't they throwing a caution?
I don't know.
I have no steering.
Robbie's fighting the car. Matt?
Well, he jumped on the radio and said, I've got a flat. You heard them say, why are they not throwing a caution? The guys are up on the wall.
Oh, no.
A great day going for Robbie Gordon. Finally, he gets the caution.
Well, that car almost went back up the racetrack.
Looks like when he got to turn three, it was just going to
look out for the end of the pit wall. Thank you. Hey, you didn't win the race. You can't do burnouts.
Go straight.
I'm impressed with that move.
Bad luck.
Goes in the corner if he has, and
yeah, definitely he had right rear, I think, went down. The way the car got loose, it looked like the right rear tire.
Another car out there that a slower car.
Oh yeah, look at them. The crush panels are ripped out of the right rear.
Oh man, that's gonna be good for him.
Yeah, that's not good either. That's really bad on a driver. All that heated exhaust inside the car.
Pit stops again with the pressure on. Last time Jamie McMurray's crew got the job done best and got him out with the lead. Here they all, it's just some rubber or something knocked loose from under one of the fender wells. Who's that? Is that Robbie Gordon slowing the inside?
Robbie again.
He's bounced off the wall again in that car. And NASCAR's trying to get him off the track in the back pits where he's coming up to now so he can stay under green.
That deal with Newman. Slowed the 29 car down a little bit. Gave Terry Labonte even more of a lead.
Richmond, caution is out. Robbie Gordon has just slid to a stop in a cloud of smoke halfway down the back straightaway.
And made a little bit of contact with the inside retaining wall with one of the front fenders. There we see the dark spot on the wall, and you see the right front fender, the damage. And believe it or not, that will hurt the handling of this race car dramatically. Will change it dramatically.
Got a serious tire rub. He's going to have to get in and fix right away.
And he's lost a lap. Let's see what happened. Robbie racing with Elliott Sadler here in the 38 for 26th place.
Looks like he got into the side of, well, he tried turning off of Elliott so he wouldn't run into him. And by turning the wheel and turning off, he got sideways and hit the inside wall.
Yeah, trying to stay off him.
Yep.
Tell you what, the exit of turn two is a very difficult exit, especially if you're coming off on the inside of someone. Let's listen to Robbie.
There's... guys, we just fine. Hang on to it. We didn't touch nothing.
Believe me, he hung on to it. But he did touch something.
I beg to differ on the didn't touch anything.
Yeah, Tim, Overby, you're a little bit wrong on that. We got a crash.
Front straightaway, Greg Biffle.
Wow.
And Mark
That's
Martin.
It. Keep digging. Nobody around you.
Oh, I think Mark
keep
just
digging.
Came out of
keep
the smoke.
Digging. Don't let him pass you. Caution is out. 74 is trying to get on the outside. Keep digging. Still there. Clear. Good job, bud. Heck of a job.
Check out the smoke screen. Biffle was running in fifth, and it looked like he did a fly-in 360 and kept on going.
Michael Waltrip has a right front tire flat, and man, look at the sparks fly.
We got a right front tire flat.
Dragging the front suspension pieces, sway bar links, and that kind of thing.
Yeah, they run these cars. Everybody runs these cars so low now that when you do get a flat tire, everything is right there dragging on the ground.
Problem is, by the time he comes down pit road and even just gets a right front tire put on it, he might go a lap down.
Yeah, I believe.
Oh yeah, Biffle just got loose.
Just lost it. Junior gets by and he nails the gas, does that 360, and somehow gets the wheel going straight. Says, only lost two spots.
I give
pretty
him a 10,
cool.
10 for that. High scores.
Now watch the smoke screen. Mark Martin gets thrown up in front of him. He's running in 10th. Biffle spins
easy,
in 5th.
Easy. Go low, go low, go low, go low, go low. Clear, clear.
And here comes the front of the field onto pit road, Dave.
With the leader.
Back at Richmond International Raceway, caution is out. The championship leader, Matt Kenseth, has gone for a spin, and Elliott Sadler has got knocked around in the traffic jam up behind him. Don't think he hit anything, Kenseth.
A little bit with the right side before it's run out. I don't think I got any damage except for getting run over.
See, he has hit the wall with the right side. We can see where he's put that Darlington strap or pancake flat in that right side. Let's see. We see some damage on the left front fender as well.
And on the left rear.
Kenseth and Jamie McMurray there, 24th position.
Looks like he got into the wall. And then the car of Todd Bodine got in the back of him. Todd had nowhere to go on that one.
I don't have any bite off the corner.
Sounds like his car's still pretty loose. No bite off the corners means the rear tires are not gripping.
And, you know, we saw Matt Kenseth hit the wall at Darlington last week and kind of ruin his car. It never performed after that like it had previously.
Elliott Sadler getting knocked around in the traffic jam.
Listen.
Oh, yeah, and he was off the throttle right before he hit the wall because rear tires had lit up. He lost traction, and he was sliding up to the wall. Marty?
Wally, they've really struggled with this car being loose today. They came in earlier, pulled a rubber at the right rear. This time, two rounds down on the track bar. Water's 235, so they're going to pull a little tape off. A little left rear damage on the car as well for the championship leader.
12 lead lap cars pit under this caution, including the leader, Jason Leffler. Mike Wallace did not. He is now out in front, while the championship leader, Matt Kenseth, is going for a spin. That cost him a lap penalty from NASCAR. Elliott's back in 42nd place.
Crash
on the backstretch. All jammed up. Steve Park is in it. Kyle Petty is in it.
Bill Elliott just got booted.
Johnny Sauter's also. Pretty heavy damage to the front of the Kodak car.
And I think he's got the radiator on that one.
There's Kenny Wallace. Looks like he doesn't have a whole lot of damage.
And that's Dave Blaney, top of the screen. The 77 nosed into the inside wall.
A lot of debris back there, though.
My guess is there'll be some mad drivers over this now.
Yeah, ooh, that would be like five or six right off the bat.
Yeah, see? we could run the total up pretty big.
Yeah.
Kyle Petty.
Oh, man.
That's too
what
big.
A shame. Kyle qualified 10th for tonight's race. Instant messenger note to Steve Park. Your race car's a mess.
There's a worm. A worm in the system.
Johnny Sauter, tonight will not go as well as last night did. And Dave Blaney.
Well, gee, I wonder if there was some contact on this, BP.
My guess is it's, let's see.
Back down here, back down.
Not really. I mean, there was contact after Dave Blaney got a little bit sideways.
Got to add Dale Jarrett's number to that accident list.
He snuck in there. He snuck out of there without
I don't think Elliott hit anything.
I think he got hit.
He got hit.
In the back.
In the jam up. Right there,
yeah,
Johnny Sauer got him.
He plowed him in the back hard, didn't he?
Yeah. The one problem about this racetrack with the sealer, although the sealer hasn't been, the track hasn't been sealed for a while, is that it does make a lot of smoke when the tires spin on it.
And when that smoke gets up and starts reflecting off the light system,
you cannot see a thing. All those guys back there, they can't see what's going on. The spotters can't see what's going on.
And the, but the spotter has the best view.
Better than the driver,
As a matter of fact, we heard Mark Martin's spotter, Tim Overby, guiding him through, go low, because Mark couldn't see anything.
Yeah.
So Craven started to drive away from his pit, and apparently the lugs weren't on the left front tire, and the tire came off.
Yep.
So now he's going to have to come back in because they left the pit box with equipment to go put the tire back on the car. 17's in, championship leader. Matt? John Andretti.
Looks like Biffle got in the back of John Andretti on that deal.
And the big stack up, Jason Leffler, Jamie McMurray. Might be a couple others in a cloud of smoke.
And Jarrett again.
I see Dale Jarrett sitting there all crashed in. Looks like Christian Fittipaldi got a piece of it, too.
I think we've already beat the Bristol deal, EP, on anger.
Oh, now some of these are repeaters.
Jason Leffler.
Right?
Yeah.
Now Kurt Busch got a piece of it.
Whoa!
Nice. Todd Bodine with all kinds of sparks.
That guy almost became a hood ornament.
Showering from his machine. There's John Andretti. There's Dale Jarrett, 1-88. And here come the leaders to pit road, including Mike Wallace, finally. Dave?
Jeff Gordon was worried before that last restart about all the debris they had run through, but that wasn't a problem. His car just a little bit tight in the middle, just a half pound of air pressure out of the right front tire for changes on Jeff's cars. Marty?
Jeff Burton liked the way the car felt that time, Dave. It'll be four tires and no changes for this 99. Much good stuff going thus far, Matt.
A little free on the previous stop, Bill.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. is here and does not like the handle of his race car at all. It's four tires. He's also concerned about the brake pedal. It's off. Back to you, Matt.
A little free on the last stop. Track bar adjustment has helped, but Spencer's going to have to back up. He's going to lose a lot of positions because the 12 car Ryan Newman blocked him in.
Boy, Newman was there for a while, too.
So we can see what happened, Wally.
Well, I think if we'll watch the one car there, and Biffle just get in the back of the one car and turn them sideways and stack them up.
Meanwhile, the wreck start happens coming off turn two, 100 yards behind the first wreck, just the chain reaction.
And they're still wrecking down the left corner of the screen.
You see the damage on the one car where Biffle got in the back of Andretti.
And there's that cloud of smoke we talked about that's hard to see through in the lights.
On board with Dale Jarrett, comes off the corner trying to get by Kenny Wallace.
He got hit getting off a two by Kurt Busch.
How about the championship leader, Ram Kenson?
On the back stretch, come on the back stretch. Back it down, back it down, got one at the bottom there. Just keep coming up top. One slow there.
Like Mike Skinner got into the 42 car.
They're all around.
Mike Kalinoff, the spotter for the 17 car, got in him through the debris.
The mayhem. And there it is. John Andretti, Greg Biffle. Tangling, bringing out the caution. Fifth one of the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. The angry driver count up to about, what, a dozen?
Yep.
That's a good number. We'll be back in a minute. TNT Sports, live in Richmond, Virginia, where another seven drivers have just been involved in a crash off turn two down the backstretch. Cleanup is complete, and we're coming to the restart.
In the wall in three, so Robbie will get his lap back.
Caution is out. Tony Stewart running sixth. Sorry, that's the sixth caution. Tony Stewart was running in 10th spot.
let's see if anybody else gets a lap back. Herbie Sadler's trying. Ricky Craven's trying.
Ain't gonna make it.
Robbie Gordon will. Made up three laps in the May race here. Did Robbie Gordon to finish fourth? He's back on the lead lap now, and we're not at halfway. So caution number six.
Let's see if we can see what might have happened to Tony Stewart going into turn three here at Richmond. Richmond, he's on the outside of Jeff Burton.
Whoa.
And Burton tried to go in on the outside of the 38 car of Elliott Sadler. And Tony was three wide. Didn't work too well.
That was kind of strange, that little deal to the right first.
He bounce off Burton there coming down into that corner.
Well, we can see
get a good look right here.
Yep, that's what it was.
Well, yeah. Clear. Just got loose. The wall, caution's out, caution's out.
So Tony Stewart goes from racing for ninth spot to 27th place after he and Jeff Burton tangle. And Stewart goes around up in the corner. Under caution again, you're watching NASCAR on TNT.
Front trouble on the track.
Casey Mears again. This time he caught the outside wall, a good one.
He was chugging. We saw him make contact just a few laps ago, and he was chugging off turn four again. And this time Kenny Schrader came up and plowed in the back of the 41 car. A lot more damage than the last time.
Add two to the angry driver total. And the caution flag out once again. This is number seven. Okay, let's investigate.
There we see the 49 car. The white car comes off the corner, and Casey, a little bit of contact, and around goes Casey.
Well, if he was pushing up toward the wall,
yeah,
and had to get out of the gas.
That's exactly what it was. He was pedaling.
Back off the throttle, and Schrader ran in the back of him.
Stewart had just been overtaken by the leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and put a lap down, and his problems have compounded themselves.
Those guys in the back stretch are getting their money's worth, aren't they?
I'm telling you. And you know, you can't see Tony and all this with these cars when they spin. You can't see them for the smoke. But I think that was the only car involved. I did not see another car involved, and unfortunately, Junior's two-second lead is now nil.
Tony Stewart was in 27th place at the time of the spin, and we are under caution for the eighth time in the race. And we're not to halfway.
Boy, he got loose way, way, way back there, about when you're jumping on the throttle. Looks like all his tires are, all tires are up.
Oh, keep it off the wall. Good job, Tony.
He had really fallen back. I mean, lost a lot of ground just before this
happened. Back, spin on the back. Clock is clear. Clock is out.
Danny Kohler, the spotter for Kevin Harvick. Got in his drop.
And here they come.
Jeff Burton, and then now there's a spin on the track.
Jamie McMurray spun right in front of Jeff Gordon. He and Dale Jarrett bounced off each other, and McMurray went around right in front of the 24, and Jeff got through.
And you know what? That 42 car was high in one and two, and I bet you he had a bunch of those marbles and stuff on his tires.
Ernie Sadler got a piece of it also.
That's too bad.
A lot of cars sliding up there in one and two. I think if you get out of the groove a little bit, it just really sucks you up to the wall.
All right, going to see everybody on pit road, and these could be the last stops of the night. 132 laps to go. Pace car gathering up the field. Let's check it out.
Yep.
In fact, Dale Jarrett in the 88 car is the driver that got on the inside and banged in the 42 car, and Jeff Gordon somehow, some way, drives through that smoke and misses the wall and the 42 car.
Look at
you
all these guys.
The 42 car had it gathered up after the 88 car got into him.
Let's see what Matt Kenseth might have seen on board his car.
Double, got one spinning the front edge back and down, right in the middle. He's right in the middle. Keep coming here. Keep coming.
Pit stop.
Hey,
hard crash. Elliott Sadler is backed into the wall in turn one.
Looks like this safer barrier might have worked for Elliott Sadler's car. Safer barrier being the softer wall technology that this racetrack has installed for this race.
First put in at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway a couple of seasons ago now. And BP, that softer wall is something that you've been advocating for a long time.
Long, long time. Since the late 90s, not even the mid-90s. And I tell you, when I walked in here and saw that, Alan, I felt so good that finally it's there.
I don't know if those body guys are going to agree with the softer wall term.
Oh, no,
though.
It's still a wall.
Well, that's why softer, not soft. I think the people that call them soft walls, I'm sorry, that's some a misnomer.
Definitely not.
Yeah. Elliott Sadler, home state of Virginia. 90 miles from here is his hometown. It's going to be a long trip, those 90 miles tonight.
It's hard to say what might have happened to cause him. And that was some heavy. Yeah, the body man, there's nothing soft about that, they will tell me.
Pit road is closed because the safety equipment there is on the apron where the cars exit the pit lane. So let's get our break in here.
System, where they charge the system.
Oh, here we go.
Contact, Bobby Gordon into the wall.
Patience ran out.
Caution's out.
Sorry, BP.
That's all right.
Ooh, that's not where you want to be sitting like that.
Man. Yellow flag, 19 laps to go. And what I said about this being Robbie Gordon's, one of his favorite racetracks.
Might have to take it back, huh?
Now, Jeff Burton may not be his favorite driver at his favorite racetrack.
And we'll add Robbie to the list of mad drivers. Yeah.
Got into him. I didn't mean to.
But that, you know, you're racing hard here, and when you're on the bottom especially, you start running that car in a little bit harder. Burton probably tried to get in a little bit deeper than he was before, and it's real easy to slide up the racetrack. Where you see him, they're racing hard.
And Jeff just lost the front end there for a second, and Rusty Wallace takes advantage of that to get by Matt Kenseth.
Robbie. Stay on the bottom, buddy.
That's...
Just bring your nose to the grass here, Robbie.
Car's not that bad, and it's either left front tire.
I think you couldn't need more of that, bud.
Attaboy, Robbie.
His glass is always half full, isn't it?
Pit stops among lead lap cars. Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin, Jimmy Johnson. Got John Andretti in.
Singular car, and we see Jeff Burton go.
Oh, 99 just putted us in the wall.
And you're right, BP, you can see that.
Putted us in the wall, left corner, going down.
That car really did slide up the track. Jeff Burton's car really did take a push.
So under caution, now 17 laps to go. Kevin Harvick gets to close up the deficit. He had to Ryan Newman and get another crack at it.
Trying to get to the bumper of the 12 car, but he pays for it.
Oh, loose.
And crashed.
Oh, no.
Back down into traffic. Look out.
Wow.
Kenny Wallace taking the high side, and the caution flag is out. Kevin Harvick's not going to finish second tonight.
He sure tried.
Yep.
We showed you Ricky Rudd and Kevin Harvick a couple of years ago when Rudd was driving the 28 car. Well, looked like that was Harvick and Rudd again here at Richmond.
Did he get into him? That's what I want to see here.
Yep, he sure did.
Yep.
And boy, we talk about this all the time, Benny. When you get hit going into a corner, you don't save that race car.
Nothing you can do except that.
Yeah.
Back it in the fence.
So add Kevin Harvick to the angry drivers list.
Yeah, here we go. Here we see the right there, the contact.
And look at Jeremy Mayfield.
Mayfield picked up two spots
right
on that.
Right through to second.
I tell you what.
New player.
Hey, new player in town. Yes.
This would be the 14th caution flag of the night.
Inside.
was squeezing through. So Harvick on pit road with his damaged car. We talked about he and Ricky Rudd tangling racing for the win here. This race, 2001. Harvick gets a hold of Rudd. Watch that save.
That was one of the best saves I've ever seen.
So Rudd gets it gathered up. A few laps later, gets back to Harvick. And it was payback time.
And Rudd goes on to the victory. Dave?
BP, they stopped. They did pull out some damage, put on two left side tires, and Kevin indicated over the radio that he might like to buy Mr. Rudd a cup of coffee when this is all over. Yeah, that's not exactly what he said.
Yeah,
I understand.
We understand.
Is that with sugar? Or without?
One to go here, and he's still, look, he's in 16th now. Restart will be with four laps to go, and
this
now
is gonna get exciting.
Mayfield has his crack at Ryan Newman.
Mm-hmm. Like,
we got Robbie Gordon looking for somebody. That would be Jeff Burton.
Yep. Ricky Rudd looking, Kevin Harvick.
Harvick
looking for Ricky Rudd.
Yep. And he knows that Ricky Rudd has come to the top five impound area on pit road.
Did you hear that?
Let's be smart. That's where he's coming to find him. And so what happens in these situations is we get pit crews involved. Harvick's pit crew coming in to intervene. And an army of Winston Cup officials. And Kevin will go for a visit to the big red truck.
You know, and those Goodrich guys, they were there to protect Kevin from himself.
Yeah.
I mean, they were not. That's the only reason they were there.
They weren't there after Ricky Rudd.
No,
they were there to. Yeah.
Exactly.
These guys are going, hey, get off our car, man.
NASCAR officials telling Kevin to get off the car, get the crewman off the car. Kevin going to have his say. Well, here we go. He walked across the top of the 21. It's on.
I'll tell you what, that big official, Big Andy. Big Andy's. Think about going by Andy. There's Todd Berry, the crew chief. Matt!
Yeah.
Betting we've got Todd Berry trying to hold back Kevin. Very frustrating night, Kevin.
Yeah, I tell you what, Gene Goodrich's car was good tonight. Ricky Rudd took a cheap shot at us. And if he's going to, you know, take a cheap shot, he's going to get one back, I promise you that.
And it's off to the big red truck.
There's Pat Tryson, the crew chief for Rudd. Marty?
And Ricky being pinned to the car right now by Pat Tryson, his crew chief. Ricky, what was the contact with Kevin about?
I don't know. Kevin had trouble on the restart. He couldn't get going or something. Anyway, went down turn one. I guess he just put on the brakes a little harder than he had been, and I got in the back of him. I mean, my fault, but wasn't on purpose. It was an accident. This stuff here is just absolutely ridiculous that NASCAR will put up with us. This is our car that's going next week for the race. Look at the hood. Look at the damage. I mean, that's totally ridiculous after the race stuff like that.
What did he say to you when he climbed out of the car?
I couldn't hear him. He's, you know, got that little yap-yap mouth. I couldn't tell what he was saying.
Fireworks in Richmond.
You want drama?
We got drama.
We got it. Yeah.
We want action? We got action.
All right, and while all this is going on,